This should be good. Hello and welcome to Busy Works Beats. Actually, welcome to Music Producer Conversations. We're here with Curtis King live, live on YouTube. And we're going to talk about the state or the status, excuse me, of the producer community. And really just how many advances we've, you know, started to make. Just everything. I mean, we're really pulling together as a community. In the last couple of years, I will say, let's shout out people who just joined first. And before I go on my rant, See the Miracle, always one of the first. Zykron, what's going on? So I know I sound a little whatever. I'm going to be eating here. I'm going to be real unprofessional today. I apologize. Curtis King's under the weather a little bit as well. So we're always dedicated to bringing you value. Super RC, what's up? MD Beats. So we're talking about the status of the producer community. And you know, how to advance as a whole, because that was the goal 2 years ago, and it's starting to, excuse me, really take fruition, coming to fruition now. We see more crediting of producers ever than before, I think, in my opinion, just off of perception. So Greek Rapper, what's up? Sakul, what up? Res Beats, I'm just saying shout outs and we can hop on in. Young Chambers, what's up? Rap Salute, welcome back. I'm watching Coach Snoop and now some other coaches. Awesome. Super RC, what's up? Two Cool Beats, Tayana Zifamba. We got to make our way down in Africa. That sounds like an African name. Ascending Keys Beats, what's up? Chase on the Track. Chase on the Track. I remember I wanted to be Game on the Beat. You know how like everybody has something, something beats or something, something
yeah,
on the
yeah,
beat?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I definitely had that name path at one point. K Beats, Abakir. I'm probably saying his name way wrong. I don't know how to, excuse me. From Cyprus. I don't know how to pronounce your name. I don't know Russian letters, but shout out to you. MD Beats. Can you come to the Netherlands? Would you take a trip to the Netherlands?
I'll be down for that. I'll be down for a trip to the Netherlands. I've seen some beautiful sites. There's a Facebook that has like a bunch of videos of like the most beautiful sites around the world. And I forget what time of the year it is, but the Netherlands has this kind of like plaza that you can see like the mountains and the snow up. It's one particular plaza I saw. I was like, I got to go there. I got to go.
I got to go. Awesome, man. And
you got to go.
Believe it or not, we've helped this like superstar. I mean, he's huge. He's huge over in the Netherlands. And I think he said Germany. I can't remember the other country, but he's a mega star over there. Belgium. That's it. Belgium. And the Netherlands. Shout out to him. I don't know if he wants me to release his name, but I follow him on Instagram, so you could figure out which one it is. But he's right. Huge. He has his own. He's on a like TV show. It's massive. So,
oh sweet. He says they don't have mountains. Maybe they miss where it was actually from. But I do believe it said the Netherlands. But I've never been so. You know better than I do.
What's up, Raw? What's up, Mushtrill? So what are some trends you guys have seen? Because this is not just us two kind of throwing facts at you. It's more so keeping everybody informed. Would you agree? Like, you know, what's really happening? Because, I mean...
Well, go ahead. No, well, if anything, I'll be more curious to know, you know, what do you see? What are you noticing a shift? Like you were getting ready to go into a point about 2 years ago that I guess things were dramatically different than what they are now, you know, not to bring up old stuff, but like think back to the time when, you know, you had sort of the Ninth Wonders and the Static Selectors and all of these folks saying a bunch of crazy stuff about the community as it is. And now, you know, the only stuff that you hear nowadays as things have progressed is sort of just, you know, spot conversations like the JD interview. And it just seems like there's a lot less public speculation, not speculation, but public outcry against the business of online producers. It seems like even the community as it is, everybody's just sort of kind of finding their own niche and lane. What do you think?
Good question. I will say that as far as content, I'll step on the content first, then the product. So as far as the content side, I know I'm kind of taking it on a tangent, but I'll bring it back to the product side. We saw, you know, probably one of the pioneers to do it was, now I'm losing it, Mass Appeal's Rhythm Roulette.
Yeah.
So they kind of started that visual thing for the producer, like in the studio, breaking it down. This is how they make beats, so on and so forth. So on and so forth. Now you see a bunch of people doing it, and it's more embraced as like an entertainment value type of thing. So I think that's awesome that we have more, like, we're cool. Like, producers are cool. It's cool to be a producer. It's not some kind of nerd behind the computer who is just doing stuff online. And I think that
Yeah.
helps. I think that helps with the perception of the beat maker. You know, this whole thing about the beat maker, producer, and all this. And it kind of, that content kind of made the online producer have a face, which earned them respect for the people who were in the industry. You know, I never liked when people said that people online are not part of the industry. You know, the music industry has a lot of people in it. And we went to NAM, or excuse me, I went to NAM. Trizza and Oracle were there as well. Like, there's booths for things that guard the cables when you cross the street. Like, that's the music industry. There's like
Yeah.
plastic guards that cover up the cables when you're doing like a live show. That's a
Right.
whole million, however many millions they're making for their company. Just that one thing. So you, when you go to get around NAMM, forgive me guys for not answering your questions. We will try to scroll back and handle those. I do acknowledge your questions, but let's just touch on this real quick so we can have like a template or a canvas. And when you go to NAMM, you start to see buildings and buildings and buildings full of just people in the industry. So it opens your mind to what the industry actually is. And again, I think all this content is starting to legitimatize. I'm probably saying the wrong word. Legitimize, whatever.
I get what you mean,
Yeah.
though.
So it's not like they don't see us as these kind of shadow competitors. Like there's 2 million versus them. Because I think before it
Right.
was people just scared of competition. Like they don't want to get undercut by somebody on the internet who will do it for a lot less. And I think that was the misconception. But
Right.
as far as the product, when you're talking about those OGs kind of giving their opinion on the internet versus the industry selling a beat. Not everybody has access to a studio for one. Not everybody has access directly to the artist, two. Not everybody
Facts.
is gonna be, there's only one wiz or excuse me, I can't I'm putting out names. There's only one Kanye West, let's say.
Right.
So there's a billion people trying to get the one Kanye West. You know, it's not the greatest business plan. We talked about this before, like marketing to the affluent versus marketing to the non-affluent. It's two different markets. But again, not everybody understands the business side of all this. Again, it really depends on what type of business you want to create. Everybody has their own goals, perspectives. You know, my thing is, what made P90X great? It wasn't that P90X sold to Hulk Hogan and that made P90X great. P90X was great because millions and millions of people got onto the program and it changed lives. So ultimately, we're still selling to an end user at some point. So
Yeah.
it really just depends on who you want to be in that chain, in my opinion. What do you think?
Right. I mean, I'm excited to see, more people popping up because, like even someone had just made mention of, I'm not gonna mention the names, but saying that people are copying this person or copying this person. I think that's one of the last arguments that I think that once we start to evolve as an entire culture and realize that there is no sustainability of a culture with only a few leaders. You know what I mean? When there's only a few leaders in position, you're setting yourself up for the overall culture to be defeated. But here's the thing about it. When you have more people out here who are, sharing their value, when you have more people out here who are sharing their techniques, people out here who are, sharing the things that was taught to them that maybe somebody else doesn't have access to in another part of the world, I think that's how a culture thrives. That's how a culture survives and how a culture grows. And so now what I'm noticing is that, before when in my particular area game, like when I was doing YouTube videos, there was literally no other producers in my areas doing any kind of producer videos. So, with them not doing producer videos, I stood out. And you would think, I saw the vision in it. Me being the only producer in my area that was willing to make these type of videos, I saw it. I mean, I saw the opportunity to fill a void, but they saw it as, well, I think the stream might be kicking off there.
Skype tripped up, then it says,
Uh-oh. Says it's offline
oh boy. What's going
now.
on? The stream resumed. The stream is continuing. Okay. Skype is tripping though today. I'm not sure why.
And it would catch me with my mouth open too.
It's like the weird, and I'm like chipmunk cheeks. Okay. The Skype is really, 'cause, ah, oh, man. Oh boy. All right.
Do you think it would change if we just did audio?
What do you mean?
If we just did an audio conversation, would there be something that we could put like as a screenshot? Maybe like make it podcasts?
It just ended my stream. Hold on. I'm not sure what's happening, man. Give me a sec.
Okay, no worries.
You mean like, I know what you mean. Just put up like a thumbnail.
Yeah, with just audio.
Gotcha.
Maybe that'll be less information trying to get pushed through.
The heck going on here? Because when I pulled up Skype, I don't even know if I'm live still. Hold on. When I pulled up Skype, it was like, hopefully this connects it with the last stream so we don't have to do two uploads. All right, we should be back live. I apologize. My computer has been really tripping today specifically. So let me know if we're live. Can you give us a 5-5-5 if we're live? That would be deeply appreciated. So again, I apologize. Computer's tripping. 2018 says yes, stream is fine now. Thank you, Gamer Chef. Thank you.
Sweet.
Make a little thank you, FM Radio. Thank you, Rap Salute. All right.
So yeah, so basically what I was saying is this, you know, in response to the status of the producer community, I think that the thing that I think is more encouraging nowadays is that there's a lot more producers out here offering their value, a lot more that are doing tutorials. You know, as much as we love the fact that we have our particular audiences coming to us, you know, for the sustainability of a culture, which is hip hop, which is online producers, there has to be more leaders. It can't be a dictatorship. You
Right.
know, dictatorships are bound, they're bound to be destroyed at some point in time because somebody comes up who's had their eye on this position for long enough and then finds a flaw in this person's, you know, particular come up and then they tear it down. But I say this, when I first started making my YouTube videos, I noticed that there was a void in my particular area. And at the time, like really, I was only a viewer of you and maybe a few other YouTubes at the time, more so just your channel. And what I noticed was that there just wasn't a lot of people out here giving the value that needed to be given. What I'm seeing now is, you know, I put up a video and I look at my related videos and I see like four or five producers I didn't even see the week before who are garnering traffic, they're garnering attention, they're sharing their information. I think all that stuff is very important. I think that's great to see. You know, it's great to see when they come up. You know, everybody's not going to have the information you're looking for, but if there's more people out here who are doing that, that's great for the community. And I try to think of things not as just what I want, me, and what's my needs. And I think that the moment that you know, the producer community, especially the younger one, starts to think about the we instead of the me, they'll get whatever success they ultimately want, even if it is for themselves. But it has to start with we. It has to start with we. And that's the one thing I love that I'm seeing a lot more and more is that there's a lot of producers who are, you know, even if they just started producing, they're documenting it. There's value in that. Somebody who is thinking about producing and they may be 17 and you're 18 and you just started doing it, they can learn from you. You know, that doesn't have to be just from us. I think that for the sustainability of it, somebody said, I want $1 million. Well, you got to find something that 1 million people are willing to pay $1 for. It starts with we.
Now, are you talking about the people that, yeah, forgive me, guys. I'm being real ghetto today. I'm eating on cam. And this is like my
We, man.
first meal of the day.
Let that man eat. You work a whole lot for people, man.
Yeah.
Let that man eat.
I was gonna say, are you talking about more of the entertainment channels or more of the people trying to like teach stuff?
No, both. I think they both play. I think anything that builds up the conversation about what's going on in the producer community, you know, I think that the more I start, even like the publications and whatnot that I don't care for, there's a pro and a con with them covering producer topics. Even if it's not genuine, if it's ingenuine, that's fine. You know, here's the thing about it is that it sparks up a conversation, and then, you know, when these companies do it, the ads start seeing that there's ad revenue generated here because of producer videos being something that's very profitable, and which in turn helps everybody, you know, within the ecosystem. But, you know, I think if it was less focus on everybody, less focus about me, and more so about, you know, what can I do for the community instead of all the things that are wrong at the community, instead of all the things that need to change. I think if people focus more so on what can I personally provide to the community, I think that we would see less and less people, you know, on social media ranting about them getting, you know, done wrong about deals. We'll get less people, you know, angry at one another, and that's part of the ecosystem too. That has to happen, you know, because we're human beings. But I'm encouraged. I'm encouraged to see, you know, so many of you producers out there who, you know, are saying, "Look, I'm just getting started, and I'm documenting my process because there's value in this." You know, me sharing this with this community, and I'm buying time so you can eat more, because I see you going in right now.
Sorry, I choked on a piece of turkey bacon. I couldn't hold
Now you good, man. I'm trying to buy you time, but I think that's important. I think at the end of the day, figure out less about what you need. You know what you need. You know what you need, but it's not going to come from you just trying to fulfill your own needs. It may come in a short-lived amount of time, but in the long run, you're not going to get what you ultimately need until you start deciding, what can I do for others? What can I provide for others within this community? And I think more people are seeing that. They're doing it. Even if they're doing it for selfish intentions, they're at least trying to, and that's good for the entire community.
And I can say that a rising tide raises all ships. There's a difference between, you know, the people who really like follow us and know all this. They know who the real, you know, authorities of this. They know who they are. Meaning, you know, yourself, myself, Sound Oracle. There's like a few. There's a few real authorities in this space. Meaning, people who have given so much value that, you know, we have a lot of insight to provide. You know, it's not just an entertaining video. It's not, I mean, even though they're fun, it's not just, you know, one little tactic. It's everything. You know, we have so many angles to it. And I think we've earned that from the community to say that we can trust these guys. And that's something that is hard to understand. You know, because the fact that somebody trusts us to make a decision. Like, for example, you know, somebody will ask me what's the best way to mix a kick, for example. I'll tell them my way, and they'll take it as gospel. So I have to make sure that I understand how it feels for them to give me trust and how valuable that is, because it's priceless. You know, trust is priceless. So it's our duty and our obligation to really cater to our audience and really curate and keep all the wolves out. So we have a lot of responsibility. I mean, it's more than just creating content. It's about being a leader. And there's very few. So regardless of how many people are creating content, there are only a few leaders, like you said, but at least it's not one guy trying to do everything and dictate everything, you know?
That would be an issue, and that would be a huge issue, man. Because you know, you now you're dealing with, you know, human ego. Now you're dealing with, you know, somebody's bad day. Now everybody has to suffer because they're under that leadership or that regime. You know, and I see somebody had asked, I think it was Past Space that asked earlier, you know, what he said, what do I offer? Is it just my production? You know, he said, I make these certain type of beats. You know, your production is only one facet of what you are and what you do. You know, that's only one side of it. And that's the easy part for you. You know, there's gotta be something additional. Like when I look at Games Channel, and you should ask yourself, you know, what value do you see when you come to Games Channel? You know, it's more than just the tutorials, because you can get tutorials other places. It's more than just, you know, the plugins that he mentions. It's the fact that you're talking about the person. The person offers a very articulate way of breaking down very complex topics. That becomes his skill set that becomes valuable to an audience of people. So you got to figure out what it is you do that's a skill set of yours. Maybe it's your ability to make people laugh. You know, those type of things. Like, think about a Crank Lucas. That's his lane completely. He right. runs that, making producers and rappers laugh at themselves and, you know, at the industry. And that becomes, you know, the way that he provides value. If you can give somebody comedic relief after they get home from work and they hate their job, and you can make music feel so much more fun by watching a video where he's, you know, making fun of rappers that don't pay. That becomes entertainment and a service beyond just his beats. He makes beats too, but because of that service he provides, it makes you say, I wonder what his beats sound like. And sometimes he incorporates them in his videos, but that's the point, is that that's the way that you got to go about it. It can't just be about, I make dope beats and I can put you on type stuff. That can't be the only thing. And I think a lot of people have the mentality that I'm a producer. What else am I supposed to do? And it's like, you better figure that out, especially in 2018. There is no, I just do one thing. One trick ponies get ran over in these years. You know, that's why you see so many people wearing so many different hats, because you just will not survive out here, because somebody will come in. And I always use the example too, Game. I remember I was watching years ago, mm-hmm. and a homie asked me a question. We were watching, don't ask me why we were watching this. I'm just pause this whole situation. But we was watching the behind the scenes of an Omarion music video, right? Right, for a music video called Touch. And so he's dancing and whatnot, and he has like this background dancer. Mind you, the man sang the song, co-produced the song, and, you know, with Pharrell or whatnot, co-produced the song, wrote the song, and was having to do dance moves. The girl who was his co-star, all she had to do was worry about her dance moves. He was like, man, that must suck, like, to get lessons from somebody that you know can do what you do, the one thing that you do better than you, and then on top of that, more things that you have no capacity of you don't even know how to fathom doing that. You know, so I think that being a one-trick pony nowadays, you got to do more, you know, whether it's you doing the vlogging, whether it's you, you know, we're just talking about specifically YouTube. But I mean, even if it's getting into the studio and you're able to create melodic ideas lyrically as a producer, there's your other skill set that becomes a value to you being in the industry. Mm-hmm. So past basic entertainment is see, so I need to offer more entertainment, not more entertainment. You got to figure out how the entertainment that you're offering is of value to people around you. Is it entertaining to more than just yourself? Mm-hmm. You know, if I put a series out and it's not resonating with the people, I'll pull it. Cause at that point, it's not about the people anymore. It's about me. You know, like I do critique my beats. I do. And that right there is a clear example of doing for the people instead of just for myself. You know, I pretty much critique beats in the way that I would the way that I would listen to them if I was a rapper who got beats to rap on. And I would tell you my mindset immediately. Some people never get that. Or even the Can It Be Chopped? You know, I do these series Can It Be Chopped? And I'm sorry, I'm not trying to plug my shows on the podcast game, but I do Can It Be Chopped literally to show people, one, the beautiful art of sampling. As we start to get away from sampling, I want people to still see the beautiful art that it requires for sampling. Also, two, what you can do in 10 minutes when you're just in the right energy space. And then three, you know, the techniques that I use in particular. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. You know, I it's important to think of we and not just me.
Mm-hmm. And there's so many ways, excuse me. Somebody earlier asked about Sharp. He said, Tayana said, I'm probably saying that wrong again, or Tayanana says, why don't the smaller, better producers like D.Will get enough clout? You got people like Sharpie doing bigger things than him. Well, again, it's not skill. Like when I first started on YouTube, my beats sounded like I just opened up FL Studio, even though I was like a year in already kind of messing with the program. It's not where you are. It's the fact that you have the guts to do it. Like Sharp took a chance. You know, if you know his story, he was deciding if he should go to college or not. And he took a risk and said, I'm not going to go to college. I'm going to put all my energy into, what is it? All my energy into making videos, trying to make it on YouTube. And all that energy that you have to put all your energy in to get great results. Until you do that, you're not going to get any results that are worth it. You know, you're going to be like, because I remember the day I was like, okay, I'm going all in regardless. I'm going all into my business. That's the day everything changed. But you have to have something that takes you to that point. And the kid just took a risk. He took a chance in faith, and he's still growing. You know, he's going to grow as he goes. He doesn't need, I talked about this at the seminar. It's not quality versus quantity. You have to start with quantity first because you don't know what the market wants until they tell you. And then you get the feedback, and then you start to create quality. There's no way to know quality before the market tells you quality. That's why we got everybody's favorite rapper from Lil Pump to Wu-Tang Clan. And it always changes. It's because the market changes. So as far as that debate, why is D Dot Will? I think I've heard seen that name somewhere.
Oh no, I know D Dot. I've known D Dot. I'll tell you from firsthand, D Dot works his tail off. D Dot is one of them guys that he stays in the studio. And you know, he came under the leadership of Lex Luger originally, and he had to branch out and basically make a name for himself. And he does well for himself with even his drum kits that he releases. And he's all like, you go to his Instagram right now, or at least the last time I checked it, it was just nothing but, you know, studio pictures and like him working on beats. That's his life, right? But you hit it spot on, is that it's beyond just skill. You know, Jay-Z said it. If skill, he said, truth be told, if skill sold, truth, what do you say? He said, truth be told, if skill sold lyrically, I'd be Talib Kweli. I missed that whole thing up, but basically saying like if skill set was what we focused on, everybody, then you know a lot of people would be held up in a higher light. You know, obviously there's exceptions to the rule when you think about like a incredibly talented artist like a Kendrick Lamar, who you know still has an opportunity and a lane and to be a profitable artist, but also an artist that you don't typically see in the mainstream. You know, there's exceptions to the rule, but I don't suggest trying to go that route if you only see 1% of those results actually making it successful. To just like Game said, the idea is create. It doesn't have to be perfect. Just get it out first. Then you'll find your thing. Everybody's searching for their thing, but they're putting all the focus on, well, I've been planning this for 6 months, so this has to be the thing. You can't determine that for anybody else. That's literally you trying to manipulate somebody else's brain into liking what you think they should like. And it just can't be like that. So I think that when you think about a Sharp versus like a D Dot Will, you know, you got to ask yourself, where did Sharp become big at? You became big on YouTube. Where do you not see D Dot Will putting all his energy? On YouTube. You see most of his energy being put towards his Instagram. And that's why his followers push up. That's why he always has customers there. And the thing about it is, you know, I think even us as producers, we have to get out of the mindset that more people equals more success or more money.
Right.
That does not mean more anything. I always use the example of Pensado's place. You know, I had somebody tell me how valuable his channel is, and I think at the time he only had like the highest viewed video he had was like 200,000. And they were telling me how he makes more money on his YouTube than the guy that has, you know, 40 million subscribers or whatever. Like the guy that's like outrageously big because he's doing like how can I put it? Like covers of popular songs. Pensado's channel was more valuable because he got 30 sponsors first of all, who are all you know plugging, and then also too, he speaks to a demographic where most of them are, it's not unlikely for them to pay $4,000 or $5,000 for a piece of equipment. So because of that, he's more valuable to YouTube in that situation. So here's the thing about it. You got to ask, where do these producers put most of their focus? It can't just be the production, just the beats. If that was the case, you know, you would have the most elaborate beats, but nobody would know anything about you. At some point in time, if you're a fan of D Dot Will, and like I said, that's the homie. If you're a fan of him, tell him, look, I, you know, and it may be not even tell him, ask him, where do you want to be big at? Because I tell you, more than likely, he's going to tell you he wants to be big within the industry. He wants to be, you know, be notable within more so of his Instagram or whatnot and his Twitter account. But you see, people get the direct result of where they put the energy at. Their success comes from where they put the energy at. Time exposes where you put your focus at. It goes for any field, anybody who's doing anything. Time will eventually expose where you put your time at, you know, or what you're not putting your time into. So, you know, I you, we can't make you can't base you can't base you can't base skill conversations on popularity conversations. They have nothing to do with one another. They're not even related.
Right, I wanted to touch on that too. I'm glad you brought it up. But before I do that, thanks, Deshaun. He says, I really do thank God for you boys, man, because I've been asking a lot of people for information and secrets, and they don't want to tell anything. How, basically, how to get his music to the next level. So shout out to you for writing that to us. And I'm looking at the chat as well, so I'm not missing anything. But thank
Right.
you, everyone who thanked us. But yeah, I wanted people to understand that there are channels more than Sharpie. I'm not speaking on Sharpie right the second. I'm talking about other channels as well who kind of took that music production thing into the entertainment side, which is fine. We need that, you know? But I don't want you to mix up people putting out a video and it getting 20,000 views right away with like monetary success. I'm not saying every business is based on monetary success, but don't think just because somebody's popping culturally means that it translates over to the other side. Like, and plus there's people out here paying for pay, what do they call it? Play increasers to create fraudulent social proof that people actually viewed the video. So a lot of these numbers are fake anyhow. So I want you to understand that. And secondly, again, it's fine to get people's attention and bring a lot of people in, but are you converting those people to something else? What's the point in getting 200 people, 200,000 views on a video if all you're worried about is the AdSense? You know, that's only going to lead to maybe 200 to 500 bucks, and then what? So don't play that game, because then you always have to come out with a video that hits home runs every time. And it's way deeper than, again, YouTube is not our business. That's what separates us from everybody else. Some of these YouTubers, their YouTube is their business. That's all they have. And I don't mean that negatively, because that's where I started too. But like, don't judge people's influence based on their YouTube numbers. Trust me, it's not even that. It's way deeper than YouTube.
Yeah, and I see, cause I don't think we'll butcher his name, but Tayana has been very active within the chat, and I do want to acknowledge something that was mentioned, in you know, in how did who did you say? How did it was one particular producer, TM88? How did he make it? I think that right there is more of a problematic way to approach it. Because when you start looking at how did this person make it, how did this person make it, how did this person make it, you're playing catch up with somebody else's. It's what I call playing catch up with somebody else's autobiography. You're playing catch up with somebody else's Wikipedia accomplishments or Wikipedia page, right? And that's not to down anything that TM88 has done, but that is his journey. You can't look at that journey and say, I'm going to duplicate that to its exact. You know, what you're seeing a lot of times in what you're seeing, and this is from somebody that's been within the industry, and I talk to people, what you're seeing as the story of how somebody quote unquote made it or got their name out there, that is generally a doctored story to make it more simplistic so it's easily digestible and easily shareable, right? Kendrick Lamar is more than a good kid from the Mad City. But that makes it a one-liner that you can give to KTLA 5 News, and they can say, this rapper from Compton, California, that describes himself as the good kid from a mad city. That's what that's all about. That's the blog post. That's the blog title, right? That's the thing for clicks. Once you get past that, you realize that 14 other people were a part of this process. And the people that are the most influential a part of this process, you will never know their name. You will never know their name. Why? Because it's not their goal to be famous. It's their goal to connect people. It's their goal to bring people to the forefront, have people have conversations. Like, you know, I don't want to put too much information out there, but if people think that Dr. Dre found Kendrick Lamar because he watched a YouTube video, Y'all gotta that you gotta be the most naive in the world. Come on now. Like that he was not just looking on YouTube one day and was like, let me search Compton artists and see who pops up. Like, no. Come on, fam. But we believe that because that's a better story than what actually happens. Nobody wants to hear about how this person introduced this person to this person. That's not as entertaining as, you know, man, maybe I can be the next guy that just blows up on YouTube and then I get the attention of, you know, a Dr. Dre or, you know, the attention of one of my favorite producers. But that's just not how the game happens. That's not how the game works. And I think that constantly looking at other people's, you know, perceived story, or not even perceived story, their doctored story, their cleaned up story, is detrimental. It's detrimental to your success. And I think that looking at that and saying, okay, that's how I'm going to come up, it's just not going to work like that because they didn't come up like the way that you think that they came up.
Wait, where'd you hear that Dre found Kendrick on YouTube?
That was in an interview on Power 106, one of the old school, well, not old school, it's still around, but it was an interview that Dr. Dre had with Big Boy. And this was like one of the biggest moments in LA hip hop at the time. Like it was monumental because Dre wasn't talking to anybody. And then Dre went on the interview on Big Boy Radio and Power 106, and he was like, you know, there's this kid that I found. And at the time, he was already like a huge underground success, right? And he's like, there's this kid that I found from watching a YouTube video, Kendrick Lamar. And then his name just blew up all over the social medias. But you know, for people to think like that's all it takes, that you're waiting on somebody to put your name out there. I think the video he said he watched was Kendrick Lamar's Ignorance is Bliss. And that's what he was basically saying, is that that's what made him want to, you know, get in touch with them. So, you know, Jimenez says that sounds ridiculous to me. I'm sorry. I know. But when I heard it, here's the thing about it. If you're a diehard fan of an artist and somebody that is a legend, that literally is like a gatekeeper out here, acknowledges their presence, and you didn't know that they knew of one another, that right there is your excitement becomes more than common sense at that point. And I think a lot of people, you know, kind of fell into that. But it makes a better story. Because now when you do the movie and you show Dre, you know, randomly perusing YouTube, and then he finds this Kendrick Lamar, like, let me see if I can get a hold of this kid. Like, that makes a better Lifetime movie. That makes a better every kind of movie than, you know, somebody literally saying like, I want to set up a meeting with this guy because of this, and this. And I think that you know, you guys will come together and do something amazing. That's a better story than what the real story is. And
You
I don't
never
want to
know.
just single him out. I think that's just for a lot of people that you look up to. You know, they're only giving you what they want to give you of a story. That's why you cannot follow them closely as you do, because, you know, you hear people talk about their come up. The stories change and vary over time, especially as relationships change. They don't want, here's the thing about it, they don't want to give someone too much credit because it could be like, you know, a situation where they're owed money now because they credit them for introducing them to this person. Like there's money to be lost out on by telling too much of the real story. That's another part of it too.
I never heard that story, but I mean, you never know. Maybe he was watching YouTube and no, because K Dot, I mean, Kendrick used to
I
work with
mean, no,
Game. Game used to be working with Dre, so.
yeah,
But you never know. I mean, maybe he saw him on YouTube and then wanted to meet him
nah,
in
I'm not
person.
buying it. I'm not buying the
Or
game. I'm
maybe,
not buying it.
maybe.
See, but see, that's the thing about it. That's the thing about it to me is that the people who are out here, the young impressionable producers. When I was 17, if I would have seen my favorite rapper get discovered, and I thought he got discovered like that, I'd be making YouTube videos every second. I wouldn't even be watching this one. I'd be making YouTube videos as much as I could to get put on. But as you start to get into the industry and you talk to people, you realize like a lot of these things have been planned out years in advance. And people are waiting for the right timing to sort of activate the card, activate the story. You know, so no, I can guarantee you that wasn't a YouTube a random day in the billionaire life of Dr. Dre. Just check YouTube for Compton Raptors.
Hey.
Oh, I'm just now hearing. I just does not. That's especially not in that time. Today, yes, I can see that happening more so than 2010, 11. We're talking about. Now I can see that even more, but it just,
That is a certain.
especially with all the connections between them, from like you said, the game and the fact that I remember Ab Soul talking about in a song called "Day in a Life," where he's talking about Kendrick working on the Detox album with Game, right? Working on songs for that project. This is in 2009, years before he discovered him on YouTube. Not buying it. He might have looked at him after someone mentioned him and looked on you. He did not discover him on YouTube. But I think that that's the story they tell, so that people, fall into the story of, man, I can get discovered. Maybe one day, all I got to do is keep. But I think that's such a detrimental. It's detriment. It's beautiful in that you believe and that you have hopes for the future. That thing that's awesome. It's detrimental in that you think that you have to wait for somebody to be your fairy godmother to put you on. And I think that fairy godmother syndrome, that tooth fairy syndrome, like that mindset is the reason why people stay stagnant or forever stay in a position of following the status quo or following these labels and hoping that they get on their radar, and you kind of teeter the fence between being independent, being your own businessman or woman, and hoping that somebody comes and gets you. And I think that that's it's just I
That's a good point. We can kind of go back and forth on that. I just want to acknowledge a couple
sure.
of folks. Slondama says, "Game, what's your name?" Firstly, my name's Carlin, but you can call me whatever you want. Game is a lot easier to remember. And somebody wrote in, where was it at? Oh, is the food tasty? It is delicious. Shapati, I appreciate you for noticing. So yeah, today's gonna be a little ghetto on my side. But when you were saying, seeking only validation, I think there's some reason to be seeking out people who have a lot of influence in a like people who are well entrenched in an industry,
Sure.
because it saves you a lot of time, saves you a lot of worry, I guess, making mistakes. But at the same time, it's rare, so you have to kind of create that for yourself. It's not always like, let me just work and somebody's gonna magically appear. So there's two sides of the coin. So I'll start with
Sure.
being the, what is it called, the devil's advocate.
No, I'm always open for that. I'm always game for that. I mean, no pun
Game. Yeah. I'll be the
intended.
devil's advocate in this case and say, okay, so for example, let's make it on the YouTube level. Like, we've helped other channels. They came to BusyWorks Beats because we had a larger reach. I'm not gonna name the channels because they already defected and left. So forget those channels. But for example, Mr. Different, we might as well just bring it up. Mr. Different, was on the BusyWorks Beats channel. It was miscommunication, whatever. But his channel was smaller. And I caught myself discovering Mr. Different, whatever that means, right? So I gave an opportunity to come on this channel, which is a larger reach. So in that case, I would be the fairy godmother to a degree. I'm not saying that I am. I'm just saying, like, I'd
Right.
be the.
In that position, you would be looked at as that.
So should people like smaller YouTubers who are lacking growth, should they look for a bigger influencer to get them in front of a bigger audience so that they can start multiplying their growth? What do you think?
I think they got to make it make sense. When you're talking about what it and I don't know him personally, so I'm gonna speak very loosely about it, but at some point in time you had to have seen something in a Mr. Different that said, I think that he can offer some value to my channel, and then I can offer some value to him because of the reach that I give him that he does not have access to. So I think it has to make sense on some kind of level, right? You wouldn't just bring somebody on who was making like, what is it? 380p versions of tutorials, and the fonts were all off and things were just not looking good, because that represents you as well if you bring them on your channel. So at some level, you have to make it make sense. And some people have that as a plan. Some people say, I'm going to make my situation so large and so big that I'm going to sell it off. Baby from Cash Money did. He had so many records that were made from Juvenile to, you know, young Lil Wayne to, you know, the Hot. All these records were made strictly so he could sell off the catalog to I forget what label that was, but he sold the catalog off and then they cashed him out something stupid. That's why you hear like Bling Bling and insurance commercials and whatnot. You know what I'm saying? Because that happens from somebody saying, look, let's build this up so big that we get enough money that we never have to work if we don't want to. Sometimes that's people's play. That's what they want to do, right? But right, I think that right, at some point in time, that's still a mindset of growth and independence, and I want to use this as leverage to grow up. Now, that makes sense, but I think that somebody, for instance, right now, trying to create videos just so that one day they can post videos on Curtis King's channel or on Game's channel, I think that's the wrong mindset to go about it. You know, I think that the reason why, you know, we were attracted to one another in this business is because there was something that said, I see some things in this individual that are like-minded with the way that I approach my particular content or my particular business. I think it would be mutually beneficial in this situation. Or sometimes it is someone saying, you know what, I really believe in this person and I have something that they don't have, so I think that we can exchange value. But I think that going in there trying to get people's attention will alter your content. It'll make you make content that is not genuine to what you really like. You'll make content according to what everybody else really likes or what you think those people will like if you get on their radar. You may not even like it. Like imagine if I would have made it. Imagine if I said, okay, right now Game is one of my favorite YouTubers. I'm going to make nothing but on-screen tutorials to get his attention. That percentage of actually working is so low because I'm doing it literally to get his attention and I'm duplicating his own success. And, you know, I know as leaders, we're not looking for other people that are clones. We're looking for leaders in their own right because that helps us grow. Right. So everybody's not the same, obviously, but I do believe that as leaders, we're naturally attracted to people that we say, you got something original or you got something going on for yourself. You got your own lane. I think that we can exchange value. And I think also, too, it puts you in a better position as the guy coming up who has a smaller channel. It puts you in a position to say, I'm not going to come to this table until I bring some food, too. Because I think if you come to the table looking only to eat, it's a huge problem. It's eventually you'll get replaced with somebody else. You know, who actually can bring value. So in any situation, any level of business, you should never come to the table without bringing something. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just rude. Value-wise or whatever it is that you do, you can't come to the table empty.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, we have is not like you're under me. It's your own entity, your partner.
Sure.
Like somebody who's undiscovered, I would consider them a contributor, not necessarily a partner. Almost like a law firm. When you get out of law school, now I'm thinking about it, you have to start out as the lowest rung on the pole. I forget what it's called. But, you know, whatever the first start in law school is when you get into your first law firm, and then you earn yourself over the years, you become an associate, then you become a partner after a long time. Now, they may cut you in like a percentage of the company. I'm not sure how that works. I haven't spoken with them in a long time, but you have to earn partnership. Like you have to have value to offer, like you said. But I'm not saying that people we work with didn't have value. I just mean that they didn't have their own thing going. You know, It was like we had to fuel their thing. Like we're taking life energy out of us, giving it to them, making them grow. But you already had your own life energy in your own company. So we're not, right, you're not sucking life out of BusyWorks Beat. So it's a little bit different. We're trying to create a symbiotic relationship. And Irby.
Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Irby says he's heading to law school. So shout out to Irby Font.
Shout out to Irby. That's huge. Past Space said, what if the food isn't as good as everyone else is at the table? How do you address that?
Well, then that's the person who invited that person in the house's fault. Like you like, for example, when I'm looking for people to kind of come under the BusyWorks Beats umbrella, we'll call it, you know, I consider this like, you know, almost like for people who watch a lot of mafia movies, you know, Like, we want to be the godfather of it all. I'm not saying like a power thing. It's more so I want to create opportunity for people under me to have their own leadership and doing whatever they want to do. So when I'm scouting for these people can relate to movies a little bit better. So when I'm scouting for, an underboss or something like that, I'm going to be doing a lot of research. Is this person consistent? Are they conflicting, like Curtis King said, with the content that we're trying to create? Are they trying to compete? What's their ultimate goal? Are they trying to take us out ultimately? You can't trust everybody. Because if you're fueling the monster, he's going to eat you alive. That's stupid. So you got to find people who are one, not going to compete with you, for one. For two, you got to find people who can accent what you do. I'm rhyming today. And then
You
three,
on
two, you got to find that.
right
And three, you want to make sure that they're actual leaders, because my philosophy on business is I don't micromanage. Like, I have a video producer named Jay. I call him my video genius. I literally just, come up with a couple ideas and let him take the rest away. I don't sit there with him while he's editing and make all these micro decisions. That's for him to make, So you have to find people like that to get on your team. I don't know where this originated, but what was the original point? That we're.
Basically was past space saying, what if the food that you bring to the table isn't as good as as what's at the table already?
Oh, I see.
Because I kind of feel like you wouldn't I kind of feel like you wouldn't be invited to begin with, because you're not on the same energetic wavelength. We've talked about this. You're not on the same wavelength. I actually got that from you. You're not on the same energetic wavelength as the other person, so you wouldn't have to worry about that. You would not be invited to the table. Here's the thing about it. You would be invited to a table in which it makes sense for you to be there. You know what I'm saying? You don't go to Denny's looking for lobster. That's just not what it is. If you are at a Denny's level, you congregate with people who are at a Denny's level. Right? So, and that's not to side anybody. That's just say that everybody has a different audience to basically appease. So for those of you that are trying to level your way up, the first thing that I would change is not just about leveling your way up for the affection of someone else, because that's only short-lived. It's only as good as you respect them, right? Only as long as you respect them. If you don't respect them, after you've gotten to their table, because sometimes you'll get to someone's table and, like Game said earlier, sometimes you'll get to the table and realize this person really doesn't want you around, but they want your ideas or they want your energy. They need energy because they can only, kind of fake their leadership for so long. And me and Game have talked about that. There's folks that we've seen that's just like they're energy leechers. Like, they need you around. And I tell you, this industry is filled of them. Oh my God, there's so many people that I would get in a room with and I would realize, like, I would come in there humble, very humble, very humble, and say, I can't believe I'm in the room. I'm thankful to be in your presence. And then I quickly realize they don't know what the hell they're doing. They don't know what the hell they're doing, or I know more about why they are a success than they do, and their time is ticking. So when I started seeing that, I started saying, you know what? And somebody said, your favorite producer does not care about you because you're their competition. It's not always like that, but there are circumstances where it's like they either want you around so that they can soak that information and that energy up, or they either want you around, because it's almost like that whole keep your enemies close situation. And I never believed in that. I don't want the energy around me. I want to be around people that are helping me grow, because anything that's not growing is eventually dying. So I like to make sure that my relationships are built with people that can help me grow. And to be honest with you, and somebody said they got lobster from Denny's, I pray that you were not sick the next day. But if you go to the table, right? If you go to a table full of people who are all lobster eaters, people who are all of this different caliber of thinking and different caliber of doing work. If you go to that table and you have these creative ideas of how to make a grilled cheese the best thing in the world, they're not even going to be on the same wavelength to accept it, even if it's an amazing idea. They're not in that space. They're maneuvering on another game level, and not even game level. Another platform.
Yeah.
Another field. Excuse me. Another field. So you know you have to make sure that you're speaking with people that not only understand what you're pushing forward, but also they value it and they can give you valuable ideas that can help you grow along the way. But I think that so many times we just attribute someone's fame to their skill set, or we attribute their fame to, oh, they must have everything going on for themselves, and that's just not the truth. Mm-hmm. It's just not the truth.
I have a couple of points. So you made a lot of good points. And firstly, I had a note. Okay, so one is, I'm going to kind of shoot these out and then revisit these. So if you ever played the game, the Mafia game, on Xbox or PlayStation, let me know in the chat if you bought Mafia 3, because that's a really good game to kind of understand what I'm about to say. And then you spoke about, what was the last point you just made just then?
Basically about making sure that your concepts line up with the other people's concepts. Right. And if you're not operating in the same field, they won't understand what you're bringing to the table anyways.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So that you said a lot in that small amount of time. and I wanted to touch on and break it up into pieces. So firstly, yes, okay, so let me start with the negative part, which is certain people like to build cultures of competition, which is, like you said, you don't want to bring up a guy underneath you who's trying to take you out, because then that would kill your whole operation. You'd lose your position, whatever that would be. But there are, I've heard from some leaders, again, every business is different, but heard from some leaders where they want that kind of competition atmosphere in their business because they want people to always push forward. Again, some people are motivated by competition. Some people are motivated by other things. It really depends. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't want to have a bunch of people in my organization trying to do weird power moves and weird things to try to block people out and do all this. You know, they call that corporate politics. I don't think that's a healthy culture at all, because I've lived that in university where all the bio students, because I was a bio major, all the bio students were, they trained us to be super competitive against each other. It didn't lead to anything. Like, what is the point of competing against this person when we can compete against the rest of the country of pre-meds or bio people? Why are we competing against each other? Why can't we just help each other out, move forward? Right. So some people like that kind of Darwinian survival of the fittest approach. I think it's a little less humane. Like, you know, we're not really here to just kill each other off. That's not how we progress as a society. We're here to work together. But that's my philosophy. You know, other people have different philosophies.
No, I 100% agree with you. And I would even take it another level and say that competition in itself is a cheap drug. You know, it's a cheap drug that keeps satisfying you for a small amount of time. But at the end of the day, you have to imagine your dreams and your success, or if even like how the younger head said that now, like the bag. You have to imagine that your bag has your name on it and it's in a safe that only you have the combination for. And I think that a lot of producers, and really bringing it back to the entire topic of the status of producer community, is that once you start to realize that everything that you're creating has nothing to do with everyone else around you, once you understand that the people that you give value to are indeed the people that need that value from you, you'll not worry about the competition. Once you start realizing that, look, there is a bag right now that says Curtis King with two S's, not one. If it has one, it's not my bag, right? With two S's that is sitting inside a safe that only I know the combination to. We're speaking figuratively, right, or symbolically. Then there is nothing anybody else can do to disrupt that. You know, unless you're literally getting in, unless you're literally standing between me and my keyboard and my laptop and erasing every little melody that I put up on my FL Studio. Like that's like the only extreme. There is no competition. Your bag is your bag. And I think that, you know, we talked about the last NPC is that, you know, my wish for rappers who come into this industry is that they would go through like, you know, really a mental empowerment first and realize that somebody else's blessing is not your curse. And I think that when people keep having that mindset, you will never enjoy your success. You will forever have your success be predicated upon how different you are from, not different, but how much more you have than somebody else, or how much you're killing the competition. When all reality, I'll give an example. Excuse me. Thank you. Tai Lopez. Oh, that made my migraine feel so good. Tai Lopez said he used to be mentored by a billionaire who woke up every day miserable because he was third or fourth on the billionaires list. How ridiculous is, you're a freaking billionaire. But he would wake up and Ty would ask him, like, you know, how you feeling about today? How you feel today? Oh, you know, still number three on the Forbes list. But that was his whole mindset. Like, that's where he put his success at. To me, that's not success. And that's what Tai Lopez was saying, is that just because this person is a billionaire, that's not more success than the guy that works at Ralph's and is the happiest person in the world and takes care of his, you know, he loves the fact that he's able to give value by, you know, having conversations with people as a cashier, and he's able to have, you know, have very short but impactful and positive conversations that alter somebody's life. That person is more of a success than a billionaire. Some people may disagree, because it's like, no, he has more, you know, less worries because he has more money. You'd be surprised if a billionaire can be jealous about being number two on the list. Because you got to understand, to be a billionaire, at some point, it takes an obsessive amount of attention to detail for you to actually get to that level. You have to more than just love money. You have to literally have your dopamine spiked by seeing your money grow, right? By seeing a number grow. That's a dopamine spike. It's beyond just the fact that somebody says, I really want to be rich one day, and they become a billionaire. You know, because in all actuality, I forget what number they said, but they said we only need like $170,000 before every one of our needs are taken care of. Mm-hmm. And beyond that, we're just living literally in lugs or luxury. Like, it's just excess at that point. So, your bag has your name on it. That's the bigger point that I wanted to get across. Your bag has your name on it. Competition is irrelevant. I hardly ever look at anybody else's channels unless I'm being a fan of them. The moment that I start feeling myself saying, damn, maybe I should stop watching.
Mm-hmm. That was abrupt. So I would say, I'll be devil's advocate.
We need that.
We're all agreeing on everything. No, but until people really understand what it means to use yourself as your brand, that's what separates us from Walmart, Target. We're a personal brand, and we're the face of our brand. Nobody else can be us. There's no other. You can't fake. You can't be fake Curtis King. So literally, there is no way to be Curtis King. So there's. Wait, did the chat go out? Hold on. I guess my screen dropped out. Your infinite defense against competition. Now, Bill Gates, for example, I think he mentioned that money's like a measuring tool to see who's winning. Like you said, like if they're not top three or top whatever, then they feel like they're not winning. It's a winning mentality. and it's way beyond the money, because they all have enough money to live 1,000 lifetimes without any worries. You know what I mean? So it's not even about the money at that point. It's just about who's winning. And money just becomes a scoreboard. So that was one thing I wrote down, and it erased my comment that I had saved. But I work with a professional who has a billionaire client, and I asked him, okay, is his life, like, do you think he's happy? I think that's what I asked him. Do you think he's happy with all this money? And he was like, nah, man, he's actually probably has more headaches in a day than the average, you know, person.
Yeah.
And it's just.
Money's like, a responsibility.
Yeah,
it's a blessing, but it's a responsibility. You make $1 billion. How many people you think are relying upon you? You create all those businesses. You create all, like, you're creating people's livelihoods enough that it amounted to you being worth billions of dollars.
Mm-hmm. And
like there's, man, that's a responsibility.
Yeah, I wanted to kind of add in this. He owns a company called Oracle. Does software coding, and his name is Larry Ellison. He's one of those top billionaires. He's driven by competition. Now, his best friend with Steve Jobs. I don't know if this is true or not, so somebody in the chat let me know. But Steve Jobs was saying that on like his deathbed or something, that, you know, we're out here chasing all this money and success and fame, and at the end of the day, when your health is deteriorating, you don't care about any of that. So, you know, there is like a vanity aspect to it. They weren't really creating a difference in the world and doing all the things that we talked about. And that's what I think separates us from the average folks. Like, I could care less if the guy down the street is a lawyer who making $1 million a year, or a doctor doing it, because I know that they're not creating this amount of value and influence in the world. I put that way higher than your job title. Like, I feel bad sometimes when people think they're really important, like, as you know, all these titles like doctors, and I'm not saying doctors are bad, but doctors, lawyers, whatever. You know, my Facebook friends from school. It's great that you got that job, but are you making a change in the world? Are you really helping other people out? What are you doing with your position? Like, what? So I have a lot more respect for, you know, people like Curtis King, you know, than I do for whatever title you could throw. I really can't think of any other title that would be greater than what we do as far as like a value creator. I don't know how to put a name on that, what we do, but like a world changer, you know, like a really in the trenches, changing people's lives type of person. I don't know what you call that. Maybe humanitarian, but we're not doing it for free either, because you need money to propel what you're doing. And a lot of people think Mother Teresa was just some broke woman. I think she had 500 million in assets, you know, in her name. So,
No, but I knew that she definitely was. And that's the thing about it is that if people value you, is everything okay?
yeah, I guess it looked like the screen froze on the phone,
Oh.
but we're good. We're good. I'm sorry.
Well, that's what I was going to say. If people value you, and which if what you do is so valuable to a great audience, they will ensure that you have the livelihood and that you take care of the responsibilities that it requires for you to continue to give value. That's why being a billionaire is such a responsibility. To get to that point, you have had to have helped people on whatever level or whatever way that you've done it. You've had to help people so much that they continue to trust you with their money, with their dollar. And you're spot on, is that it's not about the title. It is about the value that you're giving. You know, we're living to give. That's the point of life, is to give. That's literally the point of it. You know, what is the one thing that everybody wants for self, but what is the easiest thing, yet the most difficult thing for all of us to do, is give, because we're not all promised anything. We're not promised time. We're not even promised that the dollar we'll get next will be our that it won't be our last dollar. But it's the thing that we all need to do to ensure that we get to where we want to get. There's no way around that. There's no way around that. Even if that person who's a billionaire is driven by competition, at some point they're driven by, oh, you're going to give value to this audience? Well, I'm going to compete with you and give them even more value than you've ever given them. And because of that, I'm going to be just as rich as you. And that, at some level, even though that's self-serving, they still had to have a part of them that said, how can I give better value than my competition? But that's literally the foundation of it, is that no matter what we do, we will have to give. You will have to. As long as we understand that concept, and I'm not speaking with you, and I know you definitely have mastered that, especially ever since I've known you, you've mastered that. But for the producers that are listening, start to ask yourself, okay, am I giving enough? And don't worry about whether or not, oh man, am I giving too much? Am I not going to make my money back? Like I said it and I'll say it again, that money is literally the echo of the value that you give. How much money you're accumulating, that's the echo of the value that you're giving out.
I agree. And I used to have a different, once I switched my mindset from what can I buy with $1 million to when I get to $1 million, how can I get to 10, and so on and so forth. Instead of get you have to get out of this like consumer lifestyle mindset. You can't keep taking, because I was in New York. I think my first trip to New York, which was like a year or two ago or 3 years ago. I went to New York feeling like helpless, because it felt like every turn I was, you know, taxed by somebody. Like, I had to buy food from the bar place or whatever it was, like a diner thing. I had to stay at the hotel. I had to buy, you know, transportation. I had to buy the I felt like I wasn't giving to the community. So I was never receiving anything either, meaning that it was always being taken out of me. So literally the definition of wealth is to give, less everything is going to be taken from you because you're just consuming, and that consuming drains you of your resources. So the only way to be an effective business owner or, you know, wealth builder, if you talk on that level, is to be a giver or a source so that you can stay within a community. Lest you're not going to survive in the community, you're going to get kicked out because you can't afford to stay there. Now, one more point I wanted to make was, so that's kind of big for average folks talking about wealth and all this. But as long as you change your mindset from taking and consuming and how can I get, and flip it into how can I give. Now, I used to be confused thinking that giving meant donating, like donating to a church or something. That's what I thought giving meant. But you can also... Yeah. Hold on, the audio is glitching. But you can also... hold on. I think we have a feedback loop. Hold on. Okay. Check, check. What is going on? Live chat, if you can hear me properly, can you give me a 333? I don't know why I'm hearing your mic twice. I don't know why.
So weird. Okay.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Perfect.
Okay. It was like a feedback loop, I think. But okay. A 333. Okay, thank you for the Trinity. I lost my train of thought.
Sorry about that. Yeah, no, I barely started hearing you towards the end.
That's fine. I just forgot what I was talking about.
Actually, in the stream, because I'm watching the stream as we go, but I'm completely frozen. Let me try to refresh that.
Oh, on Skype? Oh, you're talking about your screen. About... I see it. Yeah, your screen. I just realized that. Okay. Let me know if I have to give you a call back or something.
Yeah, they say they're not seeing me on there.
Okay. Okay, now... Okay, we'll figure out what Curtis King's cam is trying to do to him. But I completely forgot my point. I'm really feeling salty right now.
Sorry about that.
I had a point and I forgot. Whatever. But somebody help me in the chat. I need help. I'm relying on you, chat. Chat brothers. Somebody put 444 instead of 333. Tropical land.
Am I still live with you? You hear me? Or
yeah, you're good on the audio, but I think I'm gonna have to call you back on Skype, which is fine. I have another. You were talking about giving. Okay, that's right. Thank you, Gideon. Paying attention, General as well. Yeah, I used to think. Hold on, let me swap screens. We'll figure this out in a couple seconds. Mm-hmm. So I used to think. Let me call you back, okay?
Okay, cool.
I used to think that giving was only donating. I didn't know that giving is actually required in order to live in a community. Meaning, again, you have a set amount of resources. The only way to not have all those resources drained is to find a way to give. There we go. To find a way to give to the community. Hold on. We should be back. There he is. I was saying how... the only way to survive in a community is to give. You know, imagine starting with the defined amount of resources, like $10, let's say. Okay. And every day, you know, somebody charges you 50 cents for food. Somebody charges you 50 cents for a taxi ride. Somebody charges you 50 cents to do whatever that is, stay the night at a hotel. Eventually, that $10 is going to run out. Now, if you don't create a value if you don't create value in a product or a service, before that $10 runs out, you're out of the community. So it forces you to create value for the community that you want to live within. And that's how I felt in New York. When I went to New York, I'm like, wow, man, I feel like if I don't contribute to this society, to this economy, oh, whoops, I think I forgot to turn your audio on. I'm sorry.
No worries.
If I don't, I'm glad you took that pause. If I don't contribute to this society again, you're never going to have that return to you. So it's, giving is required. I mean, I know people try to make it sound not pompous, but what's the word I'm looking for? Like holy. It's really required in order to stay alive in a society without begging other people for stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And always hoping and getting mad when people can't give you the handout. So that's, you know, it's a mentality thing. So
yeah, that has to change before anything else. Like, and any consultation that I do, and I keep hating to make this about young producers, but I think this applies to all levels of, now that I'm realizing that certain people were just not brought up in a household that, you know, it was about giving to one another. On some level, you've experienced it, but a lot of people are not in a household. Like, I'll give you an example. My mom was a type where, you know, before she ate, she would take all the coins in the house and go down to the supermarket and go to Coinstar, and she would shovel them, you know, those loud coin machines. Everybody knows that your business, not they're looking at you like you ain't got no money. But she would shovel those coins and put them in that machine, and she would get like maybe 15, 20 bucks, and she would take that money and go to Winter Snitchel and see what her kids wanted first. And once they were fed, then she would worry about herself in the process. Now, and this is something I'm glad this person said what they said. King Darius said, giving drains your mental and physical energy depending on where your energy goes to. But it's the right direction. It motivates you to give more. Here's the thing about it. I think that's as much as I appreciate what you're saying in that, I think that is the point that I'm getting ready to make is this. When my mother would give, she put herself in a position to say, you know, I will always be taken care of, and there is abundance in me giving. There's going to always be something for me to eat. There's going to always be something for me to focus on. And I think that's the same thing with my mentality today, is that no matter how much information I give, people are like, oh my God, I can't believe you're giving this information away for free. And it's like, first of all, it's not a free exchange. One, if it was a free exchange, it would just be me standing on the corner of the street and just yelling it out and not accepting any donations. You know, I get monetized from my YouTube. And then also, too, it does drive business to the other services that I provide. But those businesses rely upon me being a value giver. I have to attract people in the way that is genuine. That is definitely something that gives them actual value, but I don't feel drained. I you know, before I left Airbit, I was doing, you know, 12 videos a week, plus making new beats, plus video editing, recording, and marketing for my book and my album. I was doing all of these things, and that wasn't for me to say like, oh, I'm doing everything and I'm proud of it. I just had to do it to get it done correctly. I could have looked at that and said, man, I'm drained. I can't give any more information. Where does 500 videos come from? Ask Game, where does the multitude of videos come from? Mm-hmm. If it's so draining, where is it coming from? At some point in time, it's got to be like, you know, this is just who you are. And this in giving fills you. But the thing about it is, if you're not giving the right thing, you will feel drained. I will agree with that. If you're not giving for the right reasons, you will feel drained. Mm-hmm. But if you're giving and you're literally saying, man, the feeling that I get from receiving, like every single day, I could never have a bad day. Even today, I got the worst migraine right now, but I could never have a bad day and be down on myself because every day somebody tells me how the content I created changed their life. What do I have to complain about? There's an abundance of reasons to feel amazing about life, no matter how crazy things get. Mm-hmm. So it's the same thing with anybody out there that is understanding or having, maybe you're at that point right now where I was at, where I unlocked it. It's not about the secret. It's not, you unlock the fact that it's about giving. And when you figure out what can you give of value and what would you give for free, And it will still be completely valuable, but you would give it for free anyways. Like, I love what I do so much, and it's something I learned from a book called The Art of Thinking Big, is that nobody that you come in contact with of influence is going to tell you nobody that you ever meet that is of influence is going to tell you there's not a route to get to where they got. They're not going to deny you that you're going to get that. Nobody of true influence and security in their position, right? So that being said, yeah, I'm sorry. I get distracted by the comments. You said since the production said life is not always good. Yeah, life is not always good. But it starts with your psychology. It starts with your mentality. and it may seem like a scapegoat. It may seem like something to overlook. No, everything starts with your mindset. When I was working at Quiznos for 4 years, I hated every single day. I hated the smell, game. I hated the smell of ranch and carbonara and freaking chili, because they would all be on your apron by the end of the night. I literally would not eat a sandwich for a year because I hated it so much. But at some point in time, it had to click. If I don't make this money here, I have no money for my studio equipment. If I don't make this money here, I'll never buy FL Studio. If I don't make this money here, I can't pay my car note, which in turn is not going to be able to, I'm not going to have transportation to get to the studio. Yeah, it wasn't good, but I was still abundant. And I realized I got to take, if I can find the good in this moment, if I can appreciate something in this moment, then I'm going to love the hell out of my abundant life. But if I can't even appreciate the things that I have right now, when most people on this earth are living under less than $2, I don't appreciate and I don't deserve any of the blessings that are going to come to me in the future, if they come. And I feel like they won't come. Take it where you're at right now and love the hell out of the worst stuff in your life right now. Love it. Love it for what it is. Love it that it's not worse than what it is. And it will change your mindset so that when abundance does come to your door, you'll recognize one another. You'll talk the same language.
You just reminded me of the days when I used to, my lunch and dinner was the same, you know, peanut butter and jelly sandwich with like oodles, what are they called? Ramen noodles. I call them oodles of noodles or whatever. But I mean, that was literally my lunch, dinner, snack, the same meal. I used to go to the grocery store with like a $15 budget and buy blueberries, eggs. I used to hard boil eggs. The worst smell for your breath. Don't do that. Don't hard boil eggs because your breath is going to be smelling horrendous. Okay. But blueberries, eggs, and I would buy bagels. That was my kind of disciplining myself because I didn't have many means to do anything else anyway. And I had to make the decision to make that sacrifice when it was in my mom's extra bedroom, parents' extra bedroom, you know, in the heat of the summer with that hot laptop on my lap, burning my lap, broken mouse wheel, you know, and I decided to convert my room into a studio. So I got rid of my bed and I forget what I put there first, but I got rid of my bed. I remember sleeping on the floor next to my, I have a computer desk, this thing that holds up the monitor right now. It's the same desk. But I replaced my bed with the computer desk, built out a little studio space, and literally just slept on the floor. I mean, it sounds like one of those hard stories, but I'm like, sleeping on the floor is not that bad, you know?
No, it's not. It's actually better for your back.
Really? Is that it?
I read this. I read this when I was sleeping on the floor with my buddies, is that the alignment that it gives your back, because you literally have to sleep straight, or you'll sleep in the most uncomfortable night that you've ever had. Like, you know those angles that you probably still to this day, even in a comfortable bed, you know those angles that you've got to sleep at for you to have a great sleep. You know, but being on the floor, like, literally straightens out your spinal cord. You know, as long as you don't have a pillow that's messing up the alignment of your spine.
Right, and it was to the point where, I mean, even my friend visited from New York, came to Philly, and I did have a bed in the other room, but I never really slept in there. I don't know why. I think it was a mental thing. But he took that bed when he came over at my parents' house, and I slept on the floor. He's like, what are you – like, there's a couch downstairs you could sleep on. So our struggles in all these things are to not only discipline you and help you understand how hard it is to really earn a dollar, but it makes you appreciate the energy and effort required into doing that. So when it multiplies and accumulates, you don't feel like – you almost kind of resent the entitlement that people have in America. You know, like, working with a team is hard enough, but like, some people really think that they should be handed a dollar just because they have a degree coming out of school.
Mm-hmm.
What's that reality for you? Because I can go on a rant about.
Oh, that I see that every day when producers say, and this is something that it's a topic that I'm addressing this week on one of my perspirations, is that, you know, one thing that I don't. And this is me personally, but I think that it's still needed because in any ecosystem, you need yin and yang. But one thing I don't particularly care for is the fact that here we are as a producer community trying to push as a whole to get more respect, yet we don't respect each other. You know how many times I see, like, even like when I do the Can It Be Chop, mind you, I'm making a beat in 10 minutes, right? And I'm giving you a real episode of me making a beat in 10 minutes, and they're not going to always be great. But when you get somebody that comes there and you know they're obviously a producer and they have like critiques that are not actually constructive, because I'm all for constructive critiques. But when you have people that come there and just literally find something to hate on because you're getting more attention than they are, and they know that them leaving a hateful comment will get them more attention than the attention they get on their own channel, that's right. A problem. That's such a problematic point of view. And it doesn't just exist there. It exists with you know, producers feeling entitlement. Like I saw Cardiac did an episode on Russian Roulette, a Rhythm Roulette recently. And on Instagram, you know, they posted up a little clip, and then a producer came in there and was like, he's like, Cardo? They might have been Cardo. He said, Cardo's dumb. Recently.
Sorry.
Yes, Cardo. That's what I said. He said Cardo's cool, but I would have killed this a whole lot better than him. My thing is, what the hell was the purpose of even saying that? And I saw that, almost said something to where it's like, that's bad for the community. What are you doing that for? You know, and you wonder why nobody else is going to respect this community if you can't respect your peers, respect one another. You have to be able to separate your preference from what you've been taught as the gospel of this is the only way to do something. You know what I'm saying? Even when a game presents you as information, he's not telling you this is the only way. He's telling you this is my way, right? But then you get people that come in there and they're so anal about details. Well, I was watching a Pensado a plug-in video and he said that this is not actually technically sound and you're not supposed to. And you know what I realize about people who are that anal about it? They hate making music. At the very core, they hate making music. Because they know too damn much. They can't enjoy the process. They forgot what it means just to have fun. This is supposed to be fun. This is supposed to be, I know it's a job for people. I know it's a career. This is supposed to be something that's an expression of you. And if you're anal, your music is going to sound as anal as you are. And that's not always a good combination. When people are acting very rigid and they're acting very, you know, this has to be perfect, their drums suck. Like that one meme. He said, the way that he talks to you, weak or whack. He said, the way that he's on a skateboard, whack. You ever seen that meme before a game?
Nah, never saw.
Oh, man, I got to share that with you. It's okay. Basically this dude on YouTube. I forget his name, but basically he's standing in the middle of the street, and it sounds like he's talking to a girl, but he's like, the way that he looks at you and never smiles, whack. The way that he walks around the house, whack. Me, I'm tight as F. And so for these folks who are out here acting like that, that's what you sound like. What are you really pushing other people down for? You know, you're burning down other buildings so that you can make your building look amazing. That's weak. That comes from a place of weakness. Right. And you have to be able to separate that sense of entitlement, that sense of that specialist mentality. I know I might have went off a little bit different of a rant, but no. That's what we sound like sometimes in this community, thinking that everything has to be perfect for you. If you don't like it, skip it. Exactly. But the fact that you have to say something about it and it's not constructive, it shows your insecurity. You got to chill.
And that's happened to me. Imagine spending tens of thousands of dollars on advertisements on Facebook just for somebody to say what you just said. A bunch of people, they're classic music theory and ease people. They think they know everything. Mm-hmm. And then we're teaching people chord codes, how to create chords using number at busyworksbeats.com/chord codes. We literally show you how to, let me pull up a keyboard. NFL Studio. Let me see something here. Let's pull up Keyscape.
I see people recognize that meme now. His hair, whack. His kickstands, whack. Go ahead.
So I can show people how to make a minor chord without knowing any scales, any names of the letters, anything. You just literally have to know how to count. So for example, I'm going to close my eyes and I'm starting at A flat. So that's a zero point, the point of rest. I know people can't see the screen, but I'm trying to make a point about people think they know everything, right? So you have the zero point, which is your A flat, and you just count up your keyboard. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That's always gonna make the minor chord 0, 3, 7, for example. Now I have people literally writing that this is wrong. And if you write out a minor chord, it's the same exact notes. So how's it wrong? So you have a bunch of people who are just stuck in their ways, and they, like you said, they're fighting against discomfort. I forget how you worded it.
Mm-hmm.
But they're fighting against
growth.
Growth, yeah.
They're afraid that somebody else has an easier way of doing something that required them to put in so much, you know, mental energy and critical thinking, they're afraid of the growth. Like they it's like the guy, it's like the and I don't know anybody like this, thank God, but it's like the guy that never wants to give up his favorite pair of shoes even though they don't fit him anymore. You know what I'm saying? It's like they don't fit you. They're hurting your feet. Your toes are literally curling backwards. Your toenails are starting to turn a different color. These are my favorite sneakers. I don't want to let them go. No. And somebody says, well, you don't have to let go of the sneakers, but you could put this orthopedic slide in there, this little gel insert, and it'll change the way it feels. Right? I know it's a crazy analogy, but it's like you put this in, and they're like, no, I don't even want that. You know how long it took me to work these shoes in? And that's what they sound like, man. And that's why, like, I'm so mad at people who the same people who will go criticize you for your cord strategy are the same ones that would say, there's not enough original ideas being put out there. And then somebody does it and you don't like it.
Yeah.
You know, like people just want you to be perfect in their light, knowing good and well nothing is perfect. Knowing good and well, you're only one perspective, but that's just the way some people operate, and it's unfortunate because that mentality is the reason why that person will not succeed. You will not, the higher you go up, no matter how bad these people are, the less you would find people who are so anal about the details. You get them to where they're so indifferent that literally their indifference is what attracts people who are so anal about it. Because the thing is, at the very psychological level, somebody who's anal about something, and I'm sorry, I keep saying anal so much, but somebody who's like so adamant about something, they actually subconsciously are how can I put it? They subconsciously wish to have the same indifference and blissful nature of somebody who doesn't care. So they push out their own self-reflecting insecurity, their own self-reflecting, you know, anger. They push that out on you because they wish that they understood the technique. They wish that they could go about the things that you're going about. And I had to check somebody today. Somebody left a comment today, game, and I said, nothing about what you're saying is constructive. And I can already tell by the way he made that comment. I know when I go to his page, he's going to have some tight beats up there, and it's going to be like 50 or 60 plays each. I just knew it. And that's not to insult anybody who's on their grind, but I just knew it. He was like, the drums are just not my type. They're whack. But I'm the one with the audience. How did I do that? At some point in time, you gotta take your head out your butt and realize that things don't have to be perfect for you to be successful. And because people are so adamant about being perfect, maybe this is the rant that you wanted to go on. I'm about to go on it, but people want it to be damn perfect. And because your obsession over being perfect, it's literally causing you to have analysis paralysis, and you will never move. You will never succeed having that mentality. Loosen up your freaking grip. There's words I really want to say, but loosen up the freaking grip that you want, that you have upon your craft, upon this game, and what you think it should be, what you think the hip hop should be about, what you think. You got to loosen up and realize that everybody has their own audience. Everybody has their own path. And there's a bag out there waiting for you. If you can let go of that measly change you got in your hand right now, you can have that. Mm-hmm. But it's a mentality that must change first.
And there's some, I dabble in like astrological things because it helps me understand relationship stuff too. And there's certain astrological signs. I think it's Virgo is one. They're very perfectionism focused. Like they are the perfectionists. I forget which other sign probably has that characteristic too. And I feel like you said, people are so worried about something being perfect the first time that it'll cost them an opportunity just because it didn't come out the way they thought it was going to come out. So the expectation is a certain way. And if it doesn't fit that expectation the first time, then they just ditch however good the opportunity in the future could be, they ditch it. And then try to figure out why nothing's ever working, and the same problem comes back over and over and over again. When you're doing anything in business, life, whatever, just put this analogy to it: the whole creation story of the universe in the Bible, it took how many days? 7 days, 6 days to create, and then seventh day was the day of rest, right? That's the story. It took 6 days. It didn't just start out perfect. It wasn't one blast and everything was perfect. If it took the creator of the universe multiple days to create perfection, why do people think that perfection is going to happen overnight? And that's creating the whole universe. Okay, so we have to take this ready, fire, aim approach, which is shoot and then figure out how to, you know, take the spaghetti that you threw up against the wall and make a meal out of it. You don't, there's no perfect. Remember, when you're doing stuff, this kind of ties to business too and relationships at the same time. But in business, there's no perfect until you get feedback from the market, which tells you this thing is quality and this is what we actually want. There's no perfect until that happens. So perfect is in itself a process.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it takes, it's a process. And
I agree.
We have too many people, and we can blame this on Disney. We can blame it on everybody, you know, who had control over culture. The Disney stories of Cinderella, you know, getting lucky and hitting the lottery and finding Prince Charming. You know, the story of, what's another kind of lottery story in Disney? That's the
Rookie
best
of the Year. Remember that baseball movie, Rookie of the Year?
Rookie of the Year.
Rookie of the Year. When a kid broke his arm, and then he had one of the best. He was like, he had to be like in his teens. He broke his arm in the backyard throwing a baseball, and then all of a sudden the Chicago Cubs signed him because he had this rocket fastball that. That's the mentality we grew up around. You know, you're spot on, man.
I forgot about that.
That's exactly. Remember that movie? Like, he ends up being better than their best pitcher because he broke his arm and it made him better. Like, it's empowering in one sense, but it's also unbelievable in another sense. But that was all I wanted to say.
Yeah, I mean, I wrote about this on my personal Facebook page. There's a way deeper psychology to it, and it's based on incentives and all this other type of stuff, intrinsic motivations versus extrinsic motivations. I'm not going to get into it, but in short, there's another example where I think I have to get into it because I don't think I can explain this without explaining it. So let's do it this way. Let's simplify it. So let's say somebody came to me and you, Curtis King on the screen. If anybody's wondering, that's the man right there on the big screen. They came to us with $100 and they said, okay, Curtis King chooses how we split that $100. But then it's up to game, me, right? It's up to game to figure out if he agrees with the deal or not. Now, if game doesn't agree with the deal, nobody gets any money. So the person gives Curtis King $100. Curtis King decides he's going to split the $100 into $70 for him and then $30 to me. I agree. Okay, and we say deal. I shake, we make a deal, and I take my $30, he takes the $70, we go away. Now, the moment, so they were testing out at what point are people going to not agree? So they gave the $100 to somebody like Curtis King. He decided, okay, now I want $80, and game, you're going to get $20. And it was at that point, once you go beyond 70-30, there's a weird psychological thing that our brain says the other person is making way more than me, and it's not fair. So I'm going to collapse the whole deal so that nobody wins. So in that case, he would take his $80, offer me $20, I would say no. And then nobody got any money. So we're both walking away with nothing. And it's a weird psychology in humans to where we would literally sabotage any up positivity. It's plus $20 to your bank account. You didn't have the $20 before. So you would literally destroy an opportunity of growth and success just because another person has a little more than you. And it's this sliding bias. It's really weird psychology, but that also ties to our decision-making when it comes to, you know, perfectionism and, you know, who's getting the better end of the deal? You know, is it a win-win? Is it a win-lose? You know, there's a lot of psychology behind these things. I'll let you kind of tap into it because I have a whole.
Yeah, well, one thing I was going to say is that, you know, with that psychology, the thing that, you know, it's the same psychology that drives people from $19.99 to $20. When you're trying to sell a product and somebody sees $19.99, like in your mind, you know that's only 1 cent less than $20. If you really sit down there, you know that. But something about psychologically seeing $19.99 instead of $20, you think that you're getting a deal as a consumer.
Right.
It's the same mindset that drives that. But understanding that, I don't know. How can I put this?
I didn't really pose any questions. That's probably why it's so open and raw.
What, No, but you're on point with that, and I think that that speaks to a bigger issue with you know the way that we interact with one another. I think if anything, I want to add to that is just continue to build up one another. Continue to if you don't like something, you don't have to voice your opinion. And I know a lot of folks, especially younger than me, came up in a generation where it was like, you know, they want you to voice every opinion about every single thing. Right. That's sort of the culture that you were brought up. Like, you got to think about even like the Disney shows, the Disney sitcom TV shows. The kids are smarter than the parents. Yeah. Right. And a part of that is, you know, the writer saying the kids deserve to have more of a voice than the parents because that resonates with the audience. But because of that, a lot of people now come up and feel like their word is more valid than somebody else or just as valid, even without experience. So I think that's a mindset that's going to be a lot of difficulty to deal with the, I hate to call it that, but the millennial generation. Mm-hmm. But those of you that are out there that are younger, who understand the essence of what we're saying and understand the need to, you know, I think it's more beneficial for you to jump into a room and be the point guard than have to be the center. Right. Using a basketball analogy. If you always feel like you got to be the center, which is really the center of attention, the person that if I stand here in the key, I need the ball. You got to pass it to me. I'm gonna get a 3-second call. Give me the ball. I demand having touches on the basketball. If you say I want to be the point guard, when you say point guard, the point guard's job is to distribute and run plays and get this offense going, right? He makes everybody else better. And I'm sorry, my missus is leaving right now. You be back soon, my love. All right. Have a good one.
Another prank on you again and just disappear.
Nah, no pranks on me, man. I can't take no pranks, man. My nerves cannot take no pranks, man. Especially dealing with her on my car. But yeah, those of you that are younger, if you understand this mentality early, I wish somebody would have exposed it to me and at least planted the seed. If you get this stuff now, if you realize that everybody else around you is only thinking about themselves, you put yourself in such a powerful position to say, I know you're thinking only about yourself. Here's what I have that's of value to you. Oh, you got my attention. Da-da-da-da-da-da. This is what I do. Da-da-da-da. All of a sudden, your exchange for that interaction is money. Go to someone else. I have value for you. If you understand that that money is an echo of your value, it's simply an echo of the value that you're giving, you'll put yourself in a position to become a leader eventually. But if you come in and you know every damn thing about every damn thing and you're not willing to listen to anybody else, I'm telling you now that you're setting yourself up for failure. You're setting yourself up to be in a position where you'll always, 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 always end up on the guy with the shorter end of the stick, right. You know, because of the way that you operate business. And people can smell, they can almost smell your greed. They can smell your self-serving energy. They can smell it on you. Right. And you won't get invited into the room.
And that's one thing I feel like... entrepreneurs or whatever we are can sense really quickly is like people's intention. It's so easy because we know firstly that somebody's not familiar. We can tell in like 2 seconds if they're familiar with us or not. Mm-hmm. And then two, we can tell again that self-serving thing. What are they trying to get out of it? And three, is it a long shot or does it make sense? You know, so that was really vague, but I'm sure you've gotten emails from companies. Again, guys, we get offered. We have integrity. That's what separates us from everybody else. I'm sure you've seen these other channels, the reviews on these random plugins. You're like, what plugin is this?
Right.
Nothing. Nobody actually uses it, and they promote bullcrap. That we don't do that. So we get offered thousands. I've gotten offers for hundreds per video to do reviews on somebody's software. I don't care. I skip over it because, firstly, mm-hmm. I don't know the person. I don't trust the company. Secondly, they're trying to make me do something like money is going to make me move. Thirdly,
<Yeah.
laughs> I already know their intention. So uh-huh. I already know they're trying to milk the producer community, so I don't even mess with them. And then fourthly, again, I'm not going to ruin my integrity and the trust I built up with you, you know, in the producer community and you know, what's the word I'm looking for? Shamish? That's not a word. I'm not going to put that to rest over one little deal. You know, I'm not that desperate in life. So
You're not willing to be a charlatan for the money, man. And I think it's beyond just the, like, people will look at that and be like, that makes you so hip hop game. And it's like, no, that makes you a stand up individual. That makes you, in my definition, in the truest essence, a man or a woman that anybody who stands for them, for their self. Like, I had people who try to offer me hat deals when I had a flat top. I'm like, who okayed this email being sent out? Think about that, gay. Like you understand it, right? When I say you that, but it's like I had a flat top. You never see me in any hats, but all of a sudden, you think I'm gonna just put a hat on top of this flat top and run in front of my audience and say, I know this may look a little weird right now, but I gotta tell you, I've never felt so comfortable with all this hair inside of a hat since I got this dad hat from so and so and so and so. And I got to tell you, if you guys get to this, hold on, let me strap it up. If you guys get to this, you too will feel like producer of the future. Like, come on. Like, but and Power Gray's right. He said they think they can buy you. Yeah, because mm-hmm. You know what? They're used to thirstiness. A lot of these companies, a lot of these brands, a lot of these people with money are used to being able to pay for whatever they want, or not even pay for it, give somebody the illusion that this look will change your life. This look can get you 4,000 more followers. Like somebody just asked probably like 10 minutes ago. Okay. I forget who it was that asked, but he asked the question, how do I get more views on my YouTube videos? I don't want to belittle your goal of getting more views, because I think that's definitely a formidable goal if you have the right intention behind it. But here's the thing about it. Somebody's going to find a way to leverage your need for that and get you to do something that you probably would never want to do because they know how badly you want that. And then when you actually get it and you get the views and you realize it's not everything that you thought it was going to be, just because you got the views, it doesn't solve anything. You're going to realize, damn, I just gave up whatever I gave up for this. This is such a cheap, you know, like Happy Meals that come with a toy. It's just a cheap toy for the Happy Meal. Like, this is what this is. I did all of this for a few toys and a Happy Meal? Really? So, you know, really understand where you're dedicating your energy. Really understand, you know, why is it that you want what you want? What do you want? Because there's a company out here right now that's going to figure out what you really, 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 really want and figure out a way to leverage it and say, oh, you're a broke producer. They're not going to say these words, but I'm going to say, you're a producer, huh? You're broke. Huh? Let me see what we can do for each other. How about I offer you, I don't know, $150? You're like, oh, my God. For what? What do I have to do? Really easy. Just do a 10-minute video with an audience that you grew yourself and that has trust in you. And I want you to put that trust on the line for my company because I gave you $150. How do you feel about that? That's it. That's in turn what they're saying to you, right? And this is, you have to realize this when somebody comes to you. Like, I get more skeptical than I used to back when I was a younger producer and somebody would come to me with money. At the time, I needed money so badly that I was open to any conversation about money, right? But I'm more skeptical now when the first thing somebody talks about is money, because what that means is that their perception of me is that I can be bought, that my ideas can be bought, that my brand can be bought, that what I'm doing is solely for the need of money. And once they realize that there's a multitude of videos sitting on my channel, once they realize there are videos where I don't ask for anything. There's no call to action at the end of the video. It's just literally me saying, I want to share this value with you. Once they realize it can't be bought, like, you become a problem to them. You actually become competition to them. I can't buy you. You won't stop what you're doing. You're a problem now for me. So they can either disrupt what you're doing or buy you out of your time. Just got to be on the lookout for that. You know, don't always believe that you're somehow less than a company because they have more money than you or more following than you. You know, a lot of times they'll approach you because they want to leverage the trust that you have with your audience. Right. It's crazy. And
they think we're like, you know, Facebook ads or something, that we could just be bought. It's really sad if you knew the business side of this. Not sad that there's no opportunity, but literally we get so many emails and opportunities from these companies, and they really think like they can just copy and paste an email that they send to everybody else, insert your name, and mm-hmm. then get you to move based on whatever they offer. you know, we work out of integrity. Again, that's what separates us from everybody else. And here's one thing I wrote down. Would you cheat for $100? Would you cheat on your spouse or on your in your relationship?
Hell no.
For $100? It's the same thing. You gotta.
Yeah.
Your business is like Christ saw the church. He saw the church as if it were his woman. And I'm using these analogies from the Bible because that's how old these principles are. It's not even about are you religious or not. These are just old principles. Christ saw the church like his wife. You know, there's this part of the Bible where Christ is going to marry the church in heaven, meaning you need to treat your decisions in business just like you would treat your decisions in a relationship. And if you wouldn't cheat for, you know, $100, now let's flip it, because guys are a little bit different. We don't really associate money with cheating. It could be just good looks or whatever. But let's say it's a girl and she's offered $100 because the other guy's a baller and he can just whatever. You know, she's alone and there's a baller comes by. He flashes some money and she's willing, and he offers like $100, I'll just say, to go do something with him in the moment, basically cheating on the relationship. So that's what separates, you know, these businesses. We just have to convert it to business language. Mm-hmm. Now I had a greater point. Wait, first I want to get to these chat comments. Blood Dragon, firstly, they had me dying laughing when they were talking about the dad cap, flat top power, make better beats if you buy this dad cap. Said past
me. I would just sit there looking at the email like that one girl in the meme, like, you realize that you're talking to somebody that has a head full of hair that couldn't fit a hat. No? Okay, we're just going to ignore that. All right, for sure.
Well, Blood Dragon, he made me pay attention. Wait, I missed a comment. Hold on, I'm missing something here. Oh, he was saying how random drum kits and loop packs. Yeah, true. He said, what's the best way of selling without sounding too salesy? Because I feel like we've been touching on some principles. What do you think?
I think. Yeah, I love that. Grant Cardone always speaks very well about that. You know, I have a book called the Closers. It's like a survival guide to how do you close on a deal, because I think sometimes in my past I have been really, really timid when it comes to selling, until I understood that selling has a very negative connotation, a very nasty connotation, because when we think of a salesman, we think of the guy that comes door to door. We think of the guy at the car dealership that knows he's selling you a lemon, right? The guy that's like, you're going to love this vehicle. You need this. But, you know, as soon as it drives off the lot, you know, wheels are going to fall apart and, you know, your warranty is going to have some flaws in it. But I think that when you start de-associating that imagery with a salesman and start realizing that it is your responsibility as a salesman to ensure that the product, first of all, is a product that can help people in whatever capacity, whether it's a producer to rapper, a rapper to producer. You must feel at your very core before you get into selling that this is going to ultimately help the person that you're selling to. That's first. Second of all, you must be so passionate about it that it literally bleeds out of your pores. And nobody can tell you any different about it being valuable from them. Now, if they say they don't want it, they don't want it. That's fine. You say, it's very unfortunate that you feel like it's not going to, you know, it's very unfortunate you feel that way, but I know that it will be value of you, but I'm able to walk away from this situation. Thank you. You have a good day. You have to have so much confidence that you're so thirsty for the dollar. But I think those things at your very core have to change. Do you really believe in your product? You know what I'm not do you think it's okay? Do you really truly believe in your product? Like when I'm selling you how to build a music producer website, I believe in this thing 110%. I wouldn't put all the hours I put into it if I didn't believe it. I can never sell a half-ass product. It's just not part of my DNA. So when I jump behind something, I'm all for it, right? But I think that a lot of times it's hard to become a great salesman when you have these insecurities, because they come out in your sales pitch, they come out in the tone of your voice, they come out in your body language. You know, when we communicate with each other as human beings, 95% of our communication is body language. 5% is the actual words we're using. So as you're watching me right now, you're looking at, you know, my erratic behavior, from my eyes dipping off into the corner, from my hands being used when I'm talking to you. You're interpreting these things as he means what the hell he's saying, right? Even the words that I'm using, but it's 5%. So you as a salesman, you got to be so jacked up. And Tony Robbins calls it getting into state, basically getting yourself into a physical state. Like you would, like if anybody who's played football, you know, the football players, they get each other wound up. They push each other. They hit each other's chest. You know, they pound like, oh, let's go, let's go. They get so jacked up that you feel like you could literally make a brick wall melt just by flinching at it. That's how much energy you have into you, right? You have to have that same energy before you go into a sale, right? Even if you're typing it out, I got to be able to feel your energy through those words that you're using. What's going on? And it may even be like using exclamation marks in certain places, maybe even using all caps if it makes sense, if it's part of your behavior, your personality. But selling is literally about getting in the right mindset. And then once you get that, I hate to keep beating it over the head, but you have to be in a position to give value to the other party. If you feel like you're doing, someone else a service, it'll change the way you talk to them. If you're doing them a disservice, you know that, you know damn well that your product is not worth the amount of money that you're selling for it. It'll come through in your body language so clearly. So I think you got to change this up here and change your relationship with what you're selling. You'll change as a salesman. If you go to my channel, you'll watch when I had to sell the hell out of this Jubilee Year project to try to get it to be number four. I had to sell the hell out of me as a person. It took me out of my comfort zone, but it also made me a better salesman, and I'm thankful for that. But you just got to believe, and you truly have to believe in your product first.
Mm-hmm. And I even went through the product on how to build your own beat website. I've gone through it. And you know, I was texting you after like every video, like, wow, I'm surprised it was step by step working through, even though I don't even use the platform. What was the platform? Website builder. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Weebly.
Weebly, that's it. Mm-hmm. Even though I didn't use Weebly, I still understood the process of building the website. That's how powerful it was. Every video or two videos, I would text you like, wow, man, I'm surprised. Next day, I will go through two more videos. Wow, man, this is really, really good. You know, however many videos it was later, man, that whole course was awesome. It wasn't too much. It wasn't overwhelming. It wasn't too little to where you felt like, you know, you're getting gypped, basically. Mm-hmm. It was perfect. It wasn't like, and the best part was that it wasn't overwhelming. So
thank you.
Appreciate I personally that. Enjoyed it, and I shared it as much as I could at the moment with everybody. So anyway, I believe in that product just as much as you do. Now, let's kind of break people's myths when we're talking about salesmen. Because somebody said you remind them of a salesman like the car dealership kind.
But yeah, and somebody else made a point too. There's good ones and there's bad ones. Mm-hmm. The good one knows what kind of car you want, and they know how to get you in that car. And the thing about it is my responsibility to get you in my car. Pause if I need to. It's my responsibility to get you to my product, because I believe that when it comes to the field that I am in, if I don't feel like anybody else is offering, and forget about everybody else, if I feel like what your goal is, if it's aligned with the product that I have, I gotta mention that. That's my responsibility. Responsibility to success, my responsibility to the time and effort that I put into the product, my responsibility to my family. I must do that. So if I feel like a car salesman, I'm doing my job. I'm a good one.
There it is. And I would, you know, I'm here to break myths, which is, what if I told you Jesus was a salesman? You know, that's going to be a video title. What if I told you Jesus was a salesman? And what that's I mean is, sales is about, entrepreneurship is about taking something that people don't believe in yet and making them believe in it until it's a reality. That's all it is. That's really bar. All it is. What's up?
I said, repeat that again. That's a bar.
Yeah. Salesmanship or entrepreneurship is about taking something that's not of this physical reality. You're taking some abstract, unrealized idea over here. The only way it can be brought into the reality from this energy that it is kind of floating around into this mass reality that we live in with hard things, you pull down energy by slowing it down. The way you slow it down is by focusing on energy. So you have to get people to focus and believe on what this energy is that you see. And you pull that energy into reality, into a mass form. That's the secret. That's what the secret's all about, really. The whole book, The Secret. You take energy and you convert it to mass. E equals MC squared. What happens if we divide M, you know, if we divide C squared from M? We convert energy into mass. So how do you divide mass by c squared. You focus on it. You slow it down by the speed of light squared. How do you do that? You focus. You pause it. So you have to get people to believe. That's the whole game of selling, business, whatever. You have to convert those people. And that's right. That's what the whole gospel is about. He's telling stories and parables about how to convert these people from non-believers into believing in this thing called the kingdom of heaven, where there's love, friendship, brotherhood, all these concepts. He's selling them on that idea. He's convincing those people to believe in something. And one more parable I meant to mention was, you know, that we spoke about this earlier, turn the other cheek. Is a parable from Jesus as well. It doesn't mean turn the other cheek and get smacked up and be a little punk. It just means, this ties into the earlier talk. I meant to mention it, but I forgot. It just means turn the other cheek from your enemy, because if you start a fight by not turning the cheek and you make it a conflict, now all your energy is being drained and they're sucking up your life energy.
So I never thought of it from that angle, but that's amazing. Yeah.
You're giving them the attention and you're basically stealing from yourself by giving them the attention. It doesn't mean be a coward. It means when these people, because my mom, for example, would pull up videos of people making fun of Busy Works beats, you know, just like random negative videos. And I'm like, that's one person out of a million people. Who cares? I don't care. I could care less. They don't entertain me. I don't even acknowledge them. And that's because
you're not doing it for them either.
Yeah, I'm not doing it for them. But if I were to acknowledge those people, I would be giving life to that enemy, you know? So that's what it means by turning the other cheek. By the way, I meant to mention that earlier, but I forgot.
Yeah. No, and that's that reminds me too. You know, I think something else in the department of selling, there's two main reasons that people buy things. I learned this from some old Tony Robbins literature, Psychology of Selling. There's two reasons why people buy things. One is either to have extreme pleasure, right? So people will buy something because they think it's going to bring their life extreme pleasure. You know, the shoes, the bed, the car, these are going to bring them extreme pleasure, right? The other reason is that they hope it's going to help them avoid extreme pain, okay? Two categories. Now start to think about the products that are out there and how many of them are the second one. You know, if I told you right now, would you want me to tell you a way how to make $20,000 or a way of how to protect $20,000 that you have already? Which one would you be more likely to want to know about? Now, I know some people will be devil's advocate and say, I want to know about that extra 20. That's cool. Most people are going to say, you know, I want to protect the money I already have. So that being said, the business now becomes, well, here's these safes. You know, here's these ways to turn into digital currency. Here's the ways that becomes the business. So you think about like what Game and I provide you when we have these products. These products literally are ways to help you avoid the pain of and frustration of not knowing what you're doing in a particular field. For somebody who wants to create a website, or even like I'll give you my book, somebody who wants to get into the music industry, but they're so worried about the pain and the cutthroat nature of it and what to expect, they can read a journey that helps them protect themselves from being in a situation that they would have to experience that pain. So them purchasing the book becomes, I'm doing this to protect myself and to avoid that pain. Now, somebody else, you know, may want, you know, my drum kits because of the extreme pleasure they think it's going to give them when their drums sound like my drums. But it's only two reasons. So as you're starting to present your beats as producers, you're presenting your beats to rappers, try to figure out which one of those two does your product at that point in time, which one does it satisfy? As a producer, you could say, my beats provide production in a niche where there just doesn't exist anymore, right? So say it's a boom bap producer. You know, you're helping to alleviate the pain of a rapper that's a lyricist that only knows how to rap over boom bap beats. You're helping to alleviate the pain and the frustration of the search. You're helping him avoid pain. So that's why they come to you. Extreme pleasure, maybe you got the number one beat on whatever website that you're on, and now people want a piece of that energy. Yo, I'm a rapper that nobody knows who I am, but at least if I got a whole project full of beats of the number one producer online, that brings value to me. That's amazing. I love that feeling. you're satisfying one of those two needs. As long as you understand that, everything becomes so much more easier to address.
Mm-hmm. I definitely agree. And we speak to the pain aspect a lot because, again, I've been in university. I had a songwriting course in university for, I don't know if it lasted a whole semester. Just one semester, because there's two semesters, right? In a year, it's two semesters in a university year. Curtis?
So one more time, I was reading the chat, I'm sorry.
And these braces make me sound really stupid sometimes too.
No, you're good.
I think it's two semesters. You got semester one, then you take a break semester two in college for a year.
Yeah.
So okay. One semester, I think it was, I took a songwriting course. Now, we went over the basics of music theory. We also went over lyric writing. But I came out of the course still confused about music theory, even though we literally went over sheet music, went over scale, we went over everything, and I did not know what the heck was going on.
Yep.
So through that pain, I've created, through observation as well, created a course called Music Theory in a Day, because I don't want people to get confused. Because I used to think 1-3-5, when I was building out sound designs, I used to think 1-3-5 was a major chord, and that would just build some nonsense sound. If you're familiar mm-hmm. with sound design and semitones, mm-hmm. it wouldn't mm-hmm. build out a chord. It would build out some nasty chord. So I always thought I was building out minor chords or major chords, and I was not even doing that when I was writing out in the piano roll. So I wanted to save people the confusion of this language of music theory and ease and bring it into the modern world where we're using sound design plugins, we're using piano rolls, we're not writing on sheet music today. That's not what we're doing. So we have all these modern tools. So that's why I created Music Theory in a Day. It solves all those problems. It says stop wasting time trying to learn from these old ways in university because they're confusing anyway, and we're going to simplify mm-hmm. it and bring you music theory. So again, I don't want people to waste that time. So I have to show them that I've gone through that waste of time. And that was
the pain
point.
Of wasting time.
Yeah. You can't buy time back. It's gone. And it's confusion as well. So it was not only was it wasted time, I still didn't even know what the heck they were teaching me at the end of the day. So it's crazy, but.
Yeah, I was going to say, and Ann Rez said, isn't pleasure just a way to avoid pain, and avoiding pain a way to get pleasure? See, this is when you start to get too deep into the subject and you start to overlook the major concept of it. Yes, you know, some people do use pain as a way to a pleasure as a way to avoid pain, but that's not everybody's mindset. Think about the guy that, you know, think about the guy that's on a yacht and he enjoys the hell out of his yacht, right? He's in the middle of the ocean. He just loves it. The views, everything, the breeze is amazing. But he's like, man, you know what will make this amazing right now? A shot of Hennessy. This will be that would give me such an amazing. He loves where he's at. He's not saying, I need a cup of Hennessy or I'm going to be in pain on this yacht. No, that's not what he's saying. He's saying this will enhance the quality of what I'm already experiencing. So you have to look at it from that aspect instead of thinking of like, oh, okay, this it must be this instead of this. It's the opposite of this. No, it's not that particular situation. You know, every time it's not an absolute, nothing happens in absolutes. So that being said, you know, just realize at what given point, like whenever you're trying to present a product to like a rapper, whoever you're selling to, understand, you have to be the one that understands more than anybody else. What need is this supplying? Is this supplying the need for pleasure or the need to avoid pain? Don't look too at it too philosophically. Don't look in too deep into that. Just look and see, you know, which one is it? Once you know what it is, it'll change the way that you put your ads up. Instead of saying like, you know, okay, I'll give you an example, drum kits, right? Say your drum kits, like the drums come through knocking, they're crazy, right? And one ad you put, need drum kits, that doesn't specifically talk to anybody, right? But if you say, do your drums suck? That gets the attention of people who have the insecurity or the pain of feeling like my drums are terrible. Now you're talking my language. Now I can get you into this particular scenario, and now you'll be open to the drum kits that I'm presenting to you. Now, for those of you that are like, oh, that's kind of dirty, you know, you're kind of pointing at people's insecurity. This is what your responsibility is when you are selling. Get it to the people that need it the most. That's your responsibility. It's not you doing anything except for exactly what your product was meant for. Your product was meant to assist people who need that particular void, that need to fill that void. That's what your responsibility is. Once you get the feeling of I'm doing something dirty by selling, I'm doing something dirty by getting my money, getting money in exchange for my product, you'll be in a much better place. I guarantee you will.
That is the key is you have to believe in it. You can't sell something you don't sell yourself on first. And Grant Cardone probably came up with that. I think you might have even said it just now, but you have to sell yourself first to believe in something. And then you can't tell somebody to believe in something you don't even believe in. And again, it comes down to belief. You can't convert your other people if you're not converted on your own thing. Mm-hmm. Somebody brought up a good question, or a good point. I mean, he said, James says he went through guitar lessons with teachers and professors, dragged out. When I started teaching myself and using online resources, I learned better and faster. So again, Curtis King can say this as well from his perspective. I've gone to places where they have large facilities, large studios. But they have no idea how to use these programs that we use. I mean, as far as like making beats or anything, they don't know how to do any of this stuff. It looks cool, but they really don't have this modern knowledge that we're offering. And it's not mm-hmm. to say that they have no knowledge, because they do have a lot of knowledge, but it's like we are the cutting edge of this music production thing. And as long as you follow, you know, solid mentors, you're going to be fine. We are the mentors that can help you get to the next step, because we've already been there. We already know Absolutely. The language. We live that life. Do Curtis and Game read the whole chat? I thought it said chart. you know what I meant to ask you? You were talking about, I was going to say this before. Did your lady come back?
Yeah. My wife to be. She's back in the building. Hey.
Oh, that's right. I forgot you guys got Oh, is that why you're wearing it?
Yeah, wait. I'm not wearing it because it's cool. I mean, it is cool, but you know. Wow. Thank you, my love. She wait. Came through in the clutch. This helps my migraines. For those who get them, get migraines, Mountain Dew has a special sugar in it that only is found in Mountain Dew. That is different from all other sodas that can help you tame the beast of a migraine. I had a doctor friend of mine that told me about this. So, I'm sorry.
Yeah. He's like, go ahead, drink some Coca-Cola. Where's my girl Game? Not here. She don't live with me.
He said not.
darn, man. Congrats. I didn't know guys got engagement rings.
Yeah, well, not even engagement. This is for the actual, we're going to just go to the courthouse tomorrow.
Tomorrow? How are you just going to let this slide by?
I mean, honestly, we were going to make it like this announcement. I mean, we would have had conversation about it too, but
yeah.
this migraine has been kicking me so bad. But no, I called today at the, I'm like all giving us business now, but I called to the courthouse today to see the process. We just got to go down there with our IDs and they do like sort of like a little mini ceremony and whatnot, but we're not going to have, the bigger ceremony until the baby's here. Oh, so yeah. I would love for you to be a part of that. I would love for you to be out here, man. You know, I know that you're not a hop and a skip away, but we'd love to have you out here.
Awesome. I mean, congrats. I had no idea. And I almost forgot that you guys were engaged together. Because I'm like, wait, do guys get engagement rings too?
Oh, no.
That's awesome, because I respect what you're doing, because you already made the commitment. Like I told my girl, whatever, in the beginning, almost like a month or so in, I'm like, don't you feel like we're married? Like, that's how I feel.
Right.
Meaning I'm that committed. Like, I'm committed forever. I'm the type of guy who doesn't dabble. If I know what I want, I know what I want. So you commit.
I think that's part of what makes you so successful at what you do, is your focus and commitment to that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's a lot to that. Like, no matter what it is, we're almost like, I don't want to say hyper consumers, but we're like, we're hyper loyalists to what we believe in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whether it's a psychology of it, you know, that's what I love about you too, bro, is that you don't operate in absolutes. You don't say that this is the only way to do things. This is how it has to be. I think those people are needed and they're necessary in the whole ecosystem. But the people I gravitate towards are the ones that can say, I can see how somebody can think like that, or I can see why that could be fact. Well, tell me more about why you feel that way. I gravitate to those people all the time.
Right.
But I think that's what makes you so amazing in what you do. Just from a friend's perspective, I'm sharing that with you.
Thank you. Yeah, and I love that because and Noah West says he's been with his girl since the eighth grade, going on 7 years, 7.5 years. Congrats on
Oh, that's beautiful.
That's a long time. I appreciate that because I realized a long time ago, nobody else controls my results except me. So why am I worried about somebody else's opinion or perspective on something? Mm-hmm. They're gonna get their own results. It's not my job to tell them what results to get, unless I'm duplicating myself. Then I would have to worry about what they believe to the core. Mm-hmm. But again, it's not my job, you know, to tell somebody else what results they want. It's just, look at my life. I get these results. If you want these results, I did this to get it. That's it.
Yeah.
And I respect what you're doing because you made that solid commitment. And then also you're putting off the partying for a while so you can actually do a good job at that ceremony party thing. A lot of people just kind of rush into the party thing, get in debt, and then it's not like the best party it could be.
You know? That ends up killing the marriage, low key. Yeah. Putting so much into the actual marriage. I don't want to get into some other subjects, but you put so much into the ceremony that, you know, you got to focus in on. I think one of the beautiful things is, like, when me and my lady got together, like, we haven't been together for a long time either, but when we got together, it was almost like because she got pregnant so early, it forced us to be in the home with each other all the time. So we literally got to bypass a lot of years that people who don't live with each other are not in each other's presence, don't get to see until they live with them. It's like somebody being together for like 4 or 5 years and they finally live with each other and realize, like, dang, I ain't realize that, you know, the girl said, I don't realize that my boyfriend, you know, likes to leave his socks everywhere around the house. And it's those little things that don't seem like a big deal that expound and become these huge issues. And you start to realize that although I have some things in common with this person, I may not necessarily like this person, you know? And with her, we had the experience of being very, very close, man, to each other. And I love that woman to death, man. I'd do anything for her. That's why when she played that prank, if those who don't know on my Instagram, she played a prank on me where, you know, she didn't do it with this intention, but for those that don't know, my car got stolen a few months ago. Some crazy stuff happened, but on the morning I had to go to New York to go speak at an iStandard event, and I'm like PTSD from that situation, from like in the past I've had cars that got repoed or whatever, and so this one actually just got stolen. So we're going to Stater Brothers one night, and she decides she wants to stay in the car. I come out to the car after I buy my ice cream and realize the car is gone and she's going in it, and then I call. And then she doesn't pick up. And then my heart is like, you know, thinking about her because she's pregnant. I'm thinking about, oh, my God. And then finally she shows up and she played a prank on me. So, yeah. But you know what you need? You need to get stretched out. Stretching produces growth. That's how we'll bring it back to the topic at hand. I know we've fallen off. Mm-hmm. But, like, stretching presents growth. Mm-hmm. And those of you that are always open to stretching, those of you that are always open to putting yourself in situations that make you uncomfortable, it will in turn make you a better human being. You will grow faster than the people around you. So I tell you this, because of our relationship, because of the fact that she got pregnant so early, we stayed in this apartment. Like, a lot of my videos are literally right in this apartment because this is where I'm always at, working, right? Because we stayed here, we had to do things like play Monopoly very early on, not for fun, because we needed that for entertainment. We bought a Wii. We did things like we have to do things together. And what happens is when you do things together with people, especially those that you love, you grow so fast with one another to where I can't even like imagine a day and not going saying what's up to my best friend. You know, we're with each other, you know. So I love it, man. I love it. And I think it's the same thing with, you know, if you don't have anybody in your life right now, producers, let that be music. Let that be music, man. Let that be music. Let that relationship grow, stretch it, you know, but don't be like a game said, don't be too concerned about what other people are saying about your lady. That's your lady. That's your relationship. You know, you're growing at the pace that you're growing. Who cares what your friend that you went to high school with? Who cares how many plays they got on SoundCloud? Forget all that. It don't matter. What matters is you love music and music loves you. Music is there for you when nobody else is there for you. When nobody else wants to listen to you express yourself, music is always open to you in whatever interpretation you want, whatever tempo you want to set. That's all upon your relationship with music. So if you don't have anybody, let music be that. But I'm telling you, when you find somebody, game can talk for this as well, is that it'll enhance every aspect of your life. That's how you know when you're with the right person, when it enhances the things that you already have going on for yourself.
Right. And I forget who said they were with their girl for like 7 years. In my head, like I said, I was hyper committed early because we spent a ton of time together in like a short amount of time. Mm. It was very dense. It wasn't like sporadic and spread out. And I think that's what led to me, you know, committing so early. And yeah, you feel like when you have somebody you really love and can cherish, it feels like there's vertical, like there's always growth to whatever you're doing. I can't describe it until you really get that feeling, but it's like I'm doing this for a reason. Yeah. You know, and you always feel like there's always something to please this person on this higher level. So that's why I respect people who are in committed relationships versus a bunch of nonsense. I don't like the player lifestyle. I don't promote it. I don't like it.
Neither do I.
I don't even know how people can handle more than one female. It's just like, it's too taxing anyway, mentally.
But yeah, it's a responsibility once again. It's almost like being a billionaire. And the responsibilities that flow.
Oh, true. And you feel like there's no depth. There's no height if you go hard, too horizontal. You feel like there's nothing deep. So I'm sick of all these shallow people. And then once you find the right person, God willing, you know, you can invest that time. Just like when you when I first decided to go all in with the business. You can't dabble in the business anymore. Mm-mm. Once you go all in, you start getting real results because you see depth and vertical and height to it. So you keep going up. And that's kind of what the ideal relationship is supposed to be. I'm not, did the screen freeze? Oh, no.
No, you're good. You got.
I was looking at my mobile phone, sorry.
Okay.
And yeah, so that's, you know, Sine, if you're watching or listening somehow, Sine Waller, shout out to you. She's the golden girl. And also, she's in a new series. I'll give her a quick plug real quick. It's a series
That's amazing.
What's up?
I said, please do it. That's amazing. That's an amazing accomplishment.
Oh, yeah. So shout out to Sine. She's in this new series coming up called FON, stands for Freaks of Nature. And it's directed by, I think her name is Chanel. Forgive me for not remembering everybody's name. But again, shout out to Sine. She's doing awesome. Again, this is the type of girl, I don't mean to be so long-winded, but this is the type of girl who told me 1 week that she's like, I think I want to be an actor. Okay, now a couple weeks later, she's a leading role in a series that's, you know, so the speed of execution is incredible. So I'm glad I could even have her in my life as far as attracting that energy, because I've spent plenty of years dealing with just, I hate shallow girls. I hate to say I hate people, but I don't chase that lifestyle. It's too
right.
So, whatever. I know I'm being, you know.
No. You're good, because I think you're tying into the reason. My pops told me one time. He told me when I was in high school, bro. Like I might have been a freshman. My pop said, your success in life, no matter what you want to become. I know you like music, son. He wanted me to pursue like education, but he told me, he said, your success in life, whatever you want to do, son, is going to be predicated upon the woman that you choose as your mate. He said, your success will be dependent upon that. I didn't understand the concept at first, but what I realized is that, you know, it's not that people are bad people. Like, you know, I don't ever think of my exes as, I try not to think of them as bad people. I just think of it as they have a different trajectory and a different priority list than I have, right? Mm-hmm. And what happens is, at the times, you attract who you attract based upon your own morale, based upon, not morale, but your own morals, and based upon the things that you value at that point in time. So here's the thing about it. The woman that game attracted came from him having to become something. Not for her, but for his own growth, he had to become something that attracted that type of an energy, that type of woman that is a self-starter who says, I'm going to go be the leading role of this TV show. I don't care what anybody else says about me. My lady, same thing with her. Like, she, people think like, yo, Curtis, man, you turned on the jets with this YouTube. You're putting out content every day. Who you think told me to do it? My lady, who happens to watch YouTubes every day. She's fans of people's YouTubes, and she never watches any producer YouTubes. Yet she's up here, she in here brainstorming with me, because she's like, I need you to, she said, I want us to have a five room house. I said, I do too. We'll watch HGTV together, right? She's like, I want a five room house. I said, I do too. She's like, well, I guess you got to go and grind. She doesn't say, But if you work more, you're going to have less time with me. She misses me. Don't get it twisted. But she has that mentality that I have when it comes to working. Like, she'll tell me, I'll be laying down with a migraine. She said, babe, you got to get up because the perspiration's got to come out tomorrow. You got to schedule them. She'll tell me that. That's better than any, and I'm not going to call her an assistant, but that's better than any kind of secretary or anything I've had, because she's my support system. I do anything for her to make sure she's okay. And she's doing this while she's pregnant. So what excuse do I have? You know? So I tell you, like, even like the way that Beat Making Haters, I have a TV show called, or I have not TV show, but an internet show called Beat Making Haters. Mm-hmm. Me and her brainstormed that concept over eating ice cream. Like that's so needed. So my thing is this: when you choose somebody to be your mate, choose somebody to be your the person that you're with, you know, obviously everything can't be perfect. It won't be perfect. It doesn't have to be perfect, but you'll know the person that is continuously pushing you up and helping you grow, that is the person that is going to last. The person that is kind of fighting against your trajectory because they're worried about you leaving them or leaving their nest or leaving their you know, their goals or whatnot, that's not going to last. And it's not just because of what your needs are. It's because of what their needs are, too. They deserve to have somebody. Like, some people don't want you to be a success, a massive success to where everybody needs you. They want you to just work at UPS. And nothing wrong with it. They want you to work at UPS, go get your paycheck, come home, and focus on family. They don't want you to have a video game vice. They don't want you to have none of that. Just focus on family, and that's it. And some people, that makes them the happiest people on the earth. Some people say, I kind of want more in life, and I want to do it in a very unorthodox way. Every woman is not going to understand that. Doesn't make them a bad person. It just means that they want what they want, like you want what you want. So in this day and time, I'm telling you, the reason why she even came in my life, I didn't look for her. I had to make a decision. After I parted ways with my last relationship, I had to make a decision. I said, the reason why things didn't work out is not just the other person's fault. At some point, I have to take responsibility for that. But no matter what's at fault, doesn't matter. I'm responsible for that, okay? So if I'm responsible for that, that means no matter where I go, I'm going to attract the same energy that I didn't like if I'm continuing to be the same person. Mm-hmm. So this is my thing. Find a way to change that you naturally want to change in a way that you want it to change that makes you happy. You'll attract the right people, not just the right relationship, the right business relationships. Not just the right woman, you'll attract the right opportunities. All of a sudden, people are not just talking money with you, but they're talking about, what do you want to create? You know, but you have to become a different person so that you can attract the opportunities that you think you deserve. It's not going to just happen because you're tight. It's not enough.
True. And then that ties into the kind of Cinderella syndrome that a lot of girls in America have, which is, because I was talking to my mom about this, how girls kind of expect, they treat it like the lottery. I mean, let's be honest. The majority, I should say, not everybody. They're trying to, like, I think Patrice O'Neal says it, like, they see guys like a lottery ticket. They scratch you, see if it's bullcrap, and then, you know, move on to the next one. Because they're brilliant. Trying to meet the ball or whatever it may be. And there's biological reasons behind that, too. But I said to my mom, I was like, what if girls passed on me just because I lived in your extra room while I was building Busy Works Beats?
Wow.
You know, just because we're in that down space for a couple of years does not mean that's where we're going to be. But that's the poor judgment people make. That's a people poor judgment making system. I mean, we can't change that. One thing that reminded me of the greatness is that I see you guys working together a lot on content, Instagram, YouTube. And I think that's beautiful because what can happen is you're so influential and a leader that can scare the female because she feels like she's going to get ditched. She has no control because relationships come down to control. And this ties to business too. So we're not just because it's Valentine's Day coming up.
But it seems like people are receptive to it. Props to the producers who are in here. Like, I'm glad you guys are talking about this because we should be talking about this more. This is something that every other channel out there or podcast, they don't touch on this because they think that you guys are one-dimensional and that you only want to hear about how to tune your 808s. Like, there's so much more value that a game has to offer you and that I have to offer you. I'm glad we're talking. I'm glad that they're receptive to this, which is what I want to say.
Yeah, and I want to kind of tie in Blood Dragon's question. Sorry. He says, how do we become the person that attracts anything you want? And I would say that it starts with your beliefs, obviously. Curtis King always talks about this. It's your belief system, and you have to, at some point, become a giver, which means you only want to receive in order to give. Until you get to that point, you're not going to be your highest self at all, because you're only going to want to take, consume, consume. You're never going to be a true giver, which is to only receive in order to give more. Mm-hmm. But back to my kind of thing was working together, because I see you guys doing the, you know, the makeup tutorial thing on Instagram.
Oh, yeah.
The Monopoly game.
She got me involved.
It's just hilarious watching you. The Chop series, she's in the back, you know, on the couch doing stuff. I mean, yeah. I love seeing her in your content, and she contributes to it as well as
she's invested into it.
Yeah, and now they feel like they're contributing to your success, so they never resent seeing you succeed. That's the problem. So here's the, like, for people who are in relationships right now and you're doing well, and the other person's not matching you as far as whatever that means. You know, you don't need to match each other either to do well. Mm-hmm. So don't ever get self-conscious about that. But at some point, sometimes these people are going to resent you because if they contribute to your success, they will feel like, okay, when he succeeds, I succeed. So they don't need to be succeeding elsewhere to feel successful. But if you're not allowing them to contribute to the success, they're going to resent it because they feel like you did something evil to achieve it. Because if their belief system says that what they do is right, then they should deserve the results. So in their head, they're thinking that you have to be doing something wrong outside of their beliefs to get those results, because they're doing what they think is right, but not getting the results. But you're doing something that's getting you the results. So they have to pitch that as evil in order to consume what's happening. So literally, if you don't allow your mate to contribute to your success, at some point, they're going to resent it and turn you into an enemy. And that's the scariest part about success. Go ahead.
No, go ahead. I'm sorry. Because I'm the reason why I'm keep saying yes, because like at this point, I'm not even a contributor to this podcast. I'm listening to your podcast right now because you're speaking facts that I haven't even thought about that perspective of. And that is the ultimate difference between this relationship and any relationship I've ever been in, is that she is the one that is the most actively involved. And it's not a ploy. It's not a ploy where she's like, well, I kind of like your beats, or no, I want to be involved. It's like, it's just so naturally happens because we're always around each other. And she says, she's not afraid to speak up either. Like, it's crazy because my lady is like 9 years younger than me, right? Mm-hmm. Right? But she has such forward-thinking ways about, she'll just tell me, like, do you think producers find that interesting when you spend that much time on that? And I'm like, no. She's like, then why do it? And I'm like, you're brilliant. You have no idea how brilliant you are for asking that. Right. I'm sorry, but I interrupted your point. I didn't want to ruin that train of thought.
Giving y'all praise, because I mean, I watch her in the critique videos, and she's like, well, you know, she'll do like a type of thing. Just be completely honest.
Yeah.
And again, your Instagram stories are hilarious. The Monopoly game was hilarious. It's just fun. I mean, it's just fun. I think it adds to whatever you're doing. It doesn't, it's not forced, like you said. It's not inorganic. It doesn't feel like you're just doing it just because to make her feel good. It's like actually adding to the moment, you know, through all.
Somebody said I'm 24. Hold on, let me address that. Someone said I'm 24. No, my lady is not 15. Stop it. I'm 33.
He's not dating Bahad Bahabi. Bahad Bahabi. But man, I'm glad we could tie that in, because these are the intangibles that drive us. Like, if I didn't have a solid female, Sine, again, if you're watching the replay, shout out to you, Sine Waller. I love you tremendously, eternally, to the highest degree. If it wasn't for her, you know, I wouldn't be motivated, because I'm at the point where money does not motivate me. And it doesn't mean I'm not getting enough money. It just means when you hit the point where you reached a goal, like, okay, so I don't want to put out numbers because I feel like that's just going to put a, you know, but once you get money, whatever that means to you, once you get money, you're like, wow, this is it. Like, this is what money is. All it does is take away the headaches of bills. That's really it. You still have to create a lifestyle. You still have to have motivation. You still have to, you know, have familial things going on. So once you have that money, you're like, wow, people are chasing this thing that's empty. You know, what I put over money is family. love, you know, God, of course. So again, once you reach that point, you realize it's just hollow. I mean, have you ever had that feeling where it's like money does not motivate you? Like the deals you might get in your emails from companies, like, okay, we could do this for you. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I'll tell you, I'd say a quick story too. Even though that's a lie, there's never a quick story with me. I'm sorry. But,
quick to you.
I was, it was about 2000 and what year was this? Probably about 2015, before I went on this journey on YouTube. And, I had already been making money as a leasing producer online. I'd been making more money than I'd ever seen in my life, right? And I was getting it coming in. I was buying all the things that I ever wanted. Like, there's a pair of shoes that I have. I'm trying to see if they're in the room, but this is a pair of Griffies that I wanted since I was 12. And then I bought them the first week that I was really starting to make some real money, right? And then it was already bought. There was nothing else to buy. Like, there was like, what else do you want? And I was like, I don't know. It's just what I didn't desire. I got in the mindset of not desiring so many things. When I finally got it, I needed more. And here's what I realized. I was leaving a show. One of my mentors performed at the House of Blues in Anaheim out here. And I was walking down in downtown Disney, right? And this is like such a movie moment, but I was walking around there. And like I broke down crying as I was walking around there. It's there during Christmas time too. And I could not explain this undeniable depression or even like feeling that I had. I just felt overwhelmed, right? I couldn't explain it. I was like, I have everything I could ever want financially. I'm in a house and all. What am I missing? And I still didn't even know what it was until I cracked open a book called The Go-Giver by Bob Berg and John David Mann. And that is the reason why I do the work that I do today, is because of that moment of desperation presented me a book that I didn't know was about giving, but I read the book. It's a 3-hour audio book. And I sat down in one listening and listened to it. And I just sat there for about an hour in silence and it didn't say anything. I just sat in there shaking my head thinking like, I got to change this. I'm finally making money. Money's not enough. That's why, like, you know, like I remember me and Mr. Postman had a bit of an exchange at the mastermind. You know, he was very passionate about, look, no, money is what I do this for. Like, I was out here living on the beach with my girl. Like, you don't understand. Money is what it's all about. And I was like, look, I feel you, bro. But at some point in time, if it hasn't happened already, you're going to realize money is not enough. Money is green pieces of freaking paper. We give so much attention to these pieces of paper. But had you took off the United States off of it, you take the president off of it, that paper is worth nothing, right? Take the number off, it's worth nothing. You wouldn't care about it. But because of what we attribute to that money, we let it run our lives. And so when I realized that, you know, from my reading I was doing, and by the way, the name of the book that I read is called The Go-Giver. The Go-Giver is on. I would suggest listening to the Audible version. I'm probably going to get a refresher this year at some point, reading it again. But it taught you things like the law of, I always butcher this, the law of reciprocity. Reciprocity. Yeah. In that you know, it's literally the law that you're going to get what you give, and we know that growing up, but we always associate value to like two hamburgers for $2 at McDonald's. That's value to us.
Right.
But when you take that away and redefine value, the same way that I valued those sneakers since I was 12 years old, those sneakers that if I would have bought them when I was 12 years old, they probably would have been like maybe 70, 80 bucks. I turn around when I was like, how old was I? Like maybe like early 30s. And I bought them for like 300, 400 bucks. That's how much I valued those, that I would do something stupid as to pay that extra money on top of it because I valued it that much. So you have to figure out what it is that you do that you can give value in and people receive as value. And then as a tool to pay you back for that value, maybe that's money they'll give you back. Maybe that's attention. Maybe that's views. Maybe that's whatever you desire. They'll go do that for you. You just got to figure it out for you. You got to figure out what it is. Mm-hmm. Really quick, I had a guy that when I started, a guy asked me a question on Facebook Messenger. He said, Look, man, I bought $10,000 worth of equipment. I just want to make hip hop beats and reggae beats. What equipment do I actually need? I already bought it. And I said, a laptop, a MIDI keyboard, some studio monitors, maybe some headphones, good RAM. That's about it. He was like, are you kidding me? I was like, no. He said, I just paid $10,000 worth of equipment. I can't find the on switch. You can't find the on switch. He's like, I don't know what I'm doing. I just went in there and let the guy at Guitar Center tell me what I should buy.
Oh, boy.
That's the first problem. So he bought all of this, and I told him, he said, man, you don't realize what you just told me is so valuable. Like, he's like, man, I redo bathrooms. Like, I'll redo your bathroom for free. Mm-hmm. Like almost like $70,000 worth of changes. He was going to come do to my bathroom for free. I said, well, I'm renting, so I can't do that. He was like, do you need guns? I can get you guns. I can get you bulletproof vest. I was like, I'm not really into guns like that either. But that is how somebody valued that little bit of information I gave him. And that may be like very second nature to a lot of you. That information was so valuable. He's willing to risk his freedom. He's willing to risk his business because of how valuable that information was to him. When I understood that concept, everything changed.
That's amazing. And it really is true. And again, it's a biblical principle. It's give without expectation. What that means is you don't know the form of the thing you're going to get back. When you give good energy, it just comes back. It's called goodwill. We'll just call it goodwill. You give goodwill, you don't know if it's going to come back in monetary form, in an access, in a favor. You don't know if it's going to come back in a relationship. You don't know what the reward's going to be. You just give, and the universe does this thing called reciprocity, which is to return what you gave. It's just like when you throw a baseball up in the air, due to gravity, it's going to come back down to the ground. It goes up, it comes back. And what I believe love really is, you know, between two people, one person's a giver, one person's a receiver, and one person gives to the other person and they receive it. And in turn, they reciprocate that energy, whatever that may be, back to the giver. So which in turn makes the giver a receiver and makes the receiver a giver. And it's the ongoing back and forth exchange, which I believe is called love. You know, that communication, that light, the highest frequency between two points is love. Mm-hmm. And it's a back and forth. It's not just one place. And, you know, there's so many dealings with this. I was going to tie it into something and I totally forgot what I was going to say. But, oh, reciprocity is that.
Yeah,
I think that's all I had to say. I feel like I'm missing something. I feel like I'm missing something, but I can't think of what that something is.
You're throwing so many powerful. I think both of us, man. Like this is so much, and that's what I meant about having believing in something so much that it bleeds through you. You know, when you believe in something so adamantly, like you'll have times where you'll have those brain farts where it's just like, oh man, like where was I going? Because we're sharing things that have made tremendous impacts in our own life, and therefore you see it within our success, you see it within the things that we do, you see it by the type of the quality of the people that we attract. Because here's the thing about it too, as you and I are talking, I'm sorry, you find your point?
Yeah, could you
go ahead,
because my brain will lose it in a millisecond.
No, I know, that's why I gotta give it back to you. Go ahead.
Okay, so the punchline to me saying all that was that the inner exchange is what I deem, it's action is what creates love, I believe. And love is just a result. It's not like, it's a resulting emotion of that back and forth. So a lot of people think love is just the emotion, but it requires that action of the back and forth. That's all I had to say.
Yeah. No, that's what I was gonna say now too, is that the audience that is in here, the 117 that I see that are watching right now, like you are the proof of what we're talking about. Even the folks that are tuning into this later on, you being attracted to this content, to listen here for now almost 3 hours, or whatever you came in, you are the proof of this concept that if you put it out into the atmosphere, you put it out into the universe, it will eventually come back. Now, do you have to learn some skills along the way? Yes. Don't get it twisted. You can't just say, I'm going to be a good person, I'm going to give, and everything's going to come to me. You still got to grow. You still got to develop skill sets. You still have to do the things that attract you to a higher level, because then the frequencies and what you're attracting will actually be enhanced by your growth. You ever wonder, like, not wonder, but how can I put this? You ever feel like life is leading you in the right direction, or life is just leading you to everywhere you go, even when it doesn't feel like a good place? You go to a bad place, but realize that had you not gone to that bad place, this good place would never have presented itself. That's when life is leading you. And sometimes we just got to allow life to lead us to where it's leading us. And in the same token, develop the skills along the way. You ever notice how, you know, for me, my biggest issues when I first was a producer was that my beats sounded like they came out of video games. Why? Because I was working on a video game called MTV's Generator, right? Mm-hmm. So that was my biggest issue. Once I got past that, my next one was that my chords sound too simplistic. Okay, now I got to run a guy that plays the piano. But the thing is, life will attract you to the people that you need at the point that you're at it. So you're coming into the game right now as a producer, 17, 18, 19, 20, thinking like, oh, I should have access to Timbaland right now, or I should have access to Metro Boomin right now. No. You need access to somebody that is going to gradually and naturally take you to the next level for you. Your next level and Metro Boomin's next level, or even Sunny Digital rapping now, like their levels are completely different. And I think sometimes we have this this misconstrued view of leveling up because of the way the internet is set up and the way that we can literally tweet something to Metro Boomin and he may like my tweet. Now I feel like, man, we're on common playing fields. Like me and, you know, he just hit me back. Like he has the same time I got, right? And I think that it's unfair to your growth. It's unfair to your process. Just take your time. Take your time. Realize that Past Space has even said right now, I'm in a very depressing space, so I use music to express how I feel. Use this moment. Use depression as a moment, because whatever you're depressed about right now, a year later, you'll be embarrassed about, right? If you're growing, you'll be embarrassed about, because you'll say, those were nothing compared to the problems I got now. Right? But that's just the natural progression of life. Breathe in these moments that you're in right now. Like right now, I've had a migraine for the last 3 hours, but I'm so excited to talk to gang, so excited to talk to you, everybody that's in here, that I'm literally focused on the goal at hand. This is what it can do to you. It can change the way you physically feel from day to day. Motion equals emotion. So if you feel depressed, first thing I would do, if you feel depressed and music is not doing it for you, past space, do this. Stand up, look into the corner of your room, and stand like Superman. Put your hands on your hip and stand like Superman. It's going to sound goofy as hell. Look into this corner. Do me a favor. Look into the corner and smile from cheek to cheek as wide as you can. And try your best to feel depressed as you felt before. Try it. It's physically impossible. Why? Because you have sent messages in frequencies to your brain that says, we're not depressed right now. But if you're making beats and you slumped over like this and you're playing the keys, this looks like somebody that is depressed. Your shoulders are slumped, your head is down, you're leaning in. These things have an effect on everything that you're doing. Mm-hmm. So that to me is even more important. Change that physiology and take time to just do some goofy stuff, because you got to change it. If you're tired of where your life is going, change a pattern. You got to change a pattern somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I can second the part about looking down. I used to ride the train a lot to intern at this hospital, and every time I would get on the train, I would look down at my phone or whatever it was. Simply looking down makes you depressed. I don't know what it is about looking down, but try not to look down. I mean, that sounds so simple. And that's only one, you know, one little caveat. But I wanted to touch on Power Gray's comment. He said, how do you teach, it's probably off the screen now, but he said, how do you teach your girl, I think reciprocity, or I think was it reciprocity? Let me check before I quote him. He said, any tips on teaching your woman about reciprocity? My lady is always on me when I'm doing something for people out of goodwill. How do you guys cope? And I had a quick thing about that is let me kind of kick it off. There's a difference between a giver and then somebody called a serial altruist, which means you will sacrifice your own good to help somebody else out. And I got to be careful too, because I can fall into that way as well, because I've helped people who just hurt me in return, you know, and I'm sitting here sacrificing my life to help other people when they don't have my own survival or self-interest at mind or in heart, I mean. So you got to be careful not to be a serial altruist, which means you're going to sacrifice stuff that you shouldn't be sacrificing for somebody who you shouldn't be sacrificing for. Now, your girl probably sees that and she values security. So you need to illustrate, again, it's not her job to believe in what you believe in. It's your job to convince her to believe in what you believe in. That's your job. The world was savages before Jesus Christ came to the world and offered this new, aspect on what we considered religion or whatnot. So it's not their job to believe automatically. So it's up to you. And you have to tie in your giving to her idea of security, which means I give because I know the universe will return in greater favor. Meaning, if I give what I can give now, I know it's going to be returned to me tenfold, a hundredfold. So
Absolutely.
doesn't that make us 10 times as secure as it did before? That's how you have to communicate that. Always speak to her security because it seems like she feels like you're just draining the resources for her kids, her progeny. And to her, it could be a foolish decision to tip that waitress an extra 10 bucks for nothing when you could have saved that 10 bucks for a bottle for your kid or whatever. I don't know how much bottles cost. So that's how she's looking at life. So you really need to dig in and always tie it back to some security aspect. But I wanted to, well, I know I'm being long-winded, but I wanted to talk about that thing where you have to go through that hardship. Like, I went through emotional death many times, unfortunately. And I do believe it's that second death that they talk about in biblical things where they're like, it's not physical death, it's a deeper death. And I think that's that emotional, hopeless place. It's not a good place. Somebody said they were depressed earlier. They might be in that hopelessness as well. So, I've been there and I can say it's just like, the story of any good story has a hero. They have the normal guy who goes through some form of death and then transforms into Superman. That's literally what's going to happen every single time. Every time you think you die, you're going to evolve into this super being and be the Superman. And that's where your breakthrough is going to come. And the only way that breakthrough would have come is if you were forced into this place of discomfort to get outside of your comfort zone. Some of the greatest things I've accomplished were right after that emotional death period. And again, you don't want this happening to you more than once in life. I wouldn't wish this on my worst enemy, emotional death. It's that bad, but we're here today. We're still alive. But again, the fact, as an entrepreneur or whoever in life, you might have to go through it multiple times, unfortunately. And it's just one of those realities. It's the absolute fire. Again, another biblical story is, I forget his name now. There's a story, somebody help me in the chat. There's a story where these guys had to, they would either bow down to this king and say that he was God or believe in their true God and then get thrown into a furnace or fire.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. Yeah, I've heard that.
Yeah, I forget their names specifically for some reason, but they decided to believe in the true God and then just get burned alive or whatever. And they went through the fire and that purified them to have gold on the other side. Meaning, life is going to put you through these tests because it proves how much you love the creator. And that's just the only way to prove it. I'm so long-winded about this, but the book of
No, you're
Daniel.
good. You're good. No, you're speaking on truth right now.
There's another story in Job where Job is a person who went through traumatic experiences. His farm fell down. It killed his wife, his kids, his animals were all killed. He was hit with leprosy. And then after that, and that was all because in the story, the creator or God allowed the devil or Satan or the adversary, meaning something that goes against you, to come test you. And the reason he allowed the devil or Satan or the adversary to come test him was to prove that Job really loved God, So, even after going through all those hardships, Job still had faith in this creator. And then once he went through that emotional death of his wife dying, his kids dying, his farm blown up, he was rewarded with that and more, after he died basically emotionally or went through that adversarial period. So, It's just like when people, unfortunately, when their pets die, they replace it with 9 new pets. It's just, it's the same thing that goes in your life, your business. Should I go to church to find a good girl? Oh no. That's a good
question. Let me say this. I saw that too. Let me answer him with this. Should you go to church to find a, worry more about if you want a girl, go to strip club. Okay? Stay with me now. Stay with me. If you want a girl, go to strip club. If you want a girl, go to the mall. Go with girls, hang out at. Go to a Mac store. If you want a better woman, or if you want somebody that's going to, you know, improve your life, you got to make sure that you start making the decisions now that will attract that kind of person. So then ask yourself this: would a better woman or a woman that is better suited for you, would she go to church? Beyond that, for you to become a better person, do you need to go to church? You gotta ask yourself that personally, right? Because it may not be, it's not about just going to any church. Some churches are good, are better for that. Some churches are not good for that. Some people, you know, some are led by leadership that they're not thinking about forward thinking. They're more so about the world is ending and everything is going to go to hell. Like, you got to find an environment that helps you grow. And the more that you grow, the more fulfilling and worthwhile relationships you will attract. I know I may sound like some spiritual mumble jumble, but it's happened way too many times in my life for it not to. So you ask a better quality question, you'll get a better quality answer. So if you ask, you know, should I go to church to find a girl? Sure. But you don't think strippers go to church? You don't think like dramatic women or dramatic girls still go to church? Like that's not enough. That's not enough. You have to make sure you're asking better quality questions. If you want to find a better woman, then you get in somewhere interesting. Okay, what does a better woman represent for you? You name the qualities. Okay, then you say, dang, that's an amazing woman. Who would I have to become for her to want to be attracted to me? A better person. Okay, let me be a better version of myself. As you're improving yourself, the places that you go, for me, it was like going to seminars. For me, it was going, you know, to better quality events. And because I did that, hello, who I attracted ended up being in those environments because they're of like minds. Now we're on the same frequency. Now we're attracted to one another. Now the conversations we are having are on the same page because we're in the same environment. We're all wanting the same thing. Maybe not the same exact, but we're wanting some very similar things, and you attract that. I think going about it all wrong and saying, I got to go find my girl, you'll be on an endless search. And there's people right now in their 60s, 70s still saying the same thing, still ain't found the one because they never took the time to say, maybe I got some work to do before the one comes. I don't think I deserve the one right now. Mm-hmm. And I could tell you, May of last year, when I moved in and I was single in my new apartment, I couldn't bring a woman here. I didn't even have a bed here yet. You know what I'm saying? Like yeah. I had to build this thing up. I had to get furniture. I had to get, you know, make it more environment friendly for somebody. But that required me to be more diligent with my business. That required me to be another human being that I didn't even know I was capable of being. When I became that person or became closer to that, all of a sudden, you know, I'm sliding in DMs on Instagram and it just made sense. And we just having conversations that attracted each other to one another. Mm-hmm. So the law of attraction is real, but you gotta put actual footwork to it. And the most of it is an internal journey. It's not about going out there and saying, man, these women suck in my city. I gotta go to the next city. No, 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 no. You gotta change who you are. And when you change who you are, you change where you go, you change who you hang around, you change what you watch, you change what you don't watch. And that will in turn attract somebody who was on that same wavelength. There's no mystery about it. There's no secret about it. That's just what it is. Mm-hmm. We like people that are like us. Your best friend, whoever your best friend is, you guys are like each other. That's why you like one another. On some degree, you're like each other. Whether it's your love for sports, your love for video, you are like each other. Whether it's your sense of humor, that's why you like this other person. Hey, I like them. Why do you like them? Because they're a reflection of who you are. So worry about your own growth first, I would say.
Yeah, and I wanted to address Sage's point real quick, Eric Sage. But I will say that, again, I can second what you were saying, is it's not about trying to chase all the time. I mean, it is, you need to put in effort, but I've been to hundreds of parties at college, you know, during my college years. I went to plenty of places searching, like hardcore searching for some kind of girl that I thought was going to magically appear in those places. But I never thought, okay, am I prepared to be the right person? You know, and all these other things. I wasn't prepared back then to even offer who I am today. I'm a completely different person than I was. Not saying I was belligerent and crazy, but again, and I've been to all these places, met hundreds of thousands of people, and then I find out Sine Waller, who I love the most, is right down the street, like an hour away. So, you know, when I went to school, it's like 2 hours away, and then we would go to Penn, that's 3 hours away, you know, crazy places. But Eric the Sage says, oh, this is kind of taking him back, sorry, but he says, I was in emotional death till I found this channel, and from that day on, my life has changed drastically. I'm not saying it out of generosity either. I was truly hopeless, waiting for my time to come. Yeah, and he was talking about the second death or something. And that's when I believe the terrible state is when, like, a joke doesn't even make you happy. That's how you know for sure you're in the dark place, is when you can't even laugh. Like, happy stuff doesn't even make you happy. That's the scariest place to ever be in the human body, I believe. And so I'm just trying to wrap up these questions, but
Yeah, the
again.
blood dragon. Can I address that one? Because that's a huge one.
Yeah. Can I shout out Sine real quick?
Sure, for sure.
Sine, love you, girl. That's all I have to say. All right, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Blood Dragon said, how are you able to tell when you grow into a valuable person? How would you measure that? Here's the thing about it. It's important to measure it, but not measure it frequently. Here's the thing about it. When you're trying to improve yourself, and I dealt with this too, but when you're trying to improve yourself for the sake of, you know, a number or a sake of something that is measurable, you're not focused on what you need to be focused on. Here's the thing about it. Your growth doesn't stop when that person comes, right? That person comes when your growth reaches a certain threshold or a checkpoint, and they say, this guy look like he really got it going on for himself. He's, you know, he dresses like nobody else I know. He talks like nobody else I know. He's very passionate. That came with work. You weren't always that person. Here's the thing about it. As you continue to grow, don't be so worried about, am I there yet? Am I there yet? Where's she at? Where's she at? She's going to come to you whether you like it or not. That's the part that blew my mind. That person is going to come to you whether you like it or not. Whether you're will be ready. You'll be ready, but whether you like it or not, that's on you. Right? So I would naturally believe that you would want that because obviously you became that for a reason. But I tell you know, it's important to measure it every once in a while because sometimes we don't know we're winning because we never look at the scoreboard. That's for one. Second of all, you know, the more that you're growing, you start to focus on the concept and the idea of growth. It becomes less and less about, well, I'm doing this to get a woman. It becomes more and more about growing because of how great you feel. Like when I was living on my own for the first time in my life, you know, I was like getting food. I was like eating, like I was eating vegan. I was, you know, eating food like I never, I was going to the gym more than I ever been going. I was feeling amazing. And because of that changed who I'm kicking it around. That change, if you're an energy drainer, I couldn't be around you. Matter of fact, the city that I live in is considered what they call the IE. I live like the last city in the IE, and it's a huge county. Nobody I know lives out here, right? But I did that purposely so that I could detox out here away from the busy city and the, you know, the gossip and all things that occur within the particular region I was in before. I did that to detox. Guess what happened when I came out here to detox? 20 minutes further out, there was a young lady that I came across that ends up becoming my fiance. That doesn't happen by chance, right? And we met before, like within the scene, but we never even had a conversation until I moved out here. And then she was 20 minutes beyond that. That is not by chance. That is life telling you, change yourself. Focus on it. I'm still growing. There's still things I got about myself that can be changed. Like I can be, my lady would tell you, I can be a smart ass. And I just have to like tame that. Because what happens is if you become too much like that, your partner will become the same exact thing. So there's so many things I'm still growing, but that happens. Like, don't worry about measuring every single second. Am I there yet? Am I there yet? Is she gonna come? Is she gonna come? I really need her. I know she look good. I know she smell good. Is she here? Is that you? Are you the one?
Don't worry about that. Focus in on the task at hand, which is ultimate growth, because now you'll have better quality conversations that will attract the very thing that you know you, not even that you want, but that you need.
Mm-hmm. And I can second that. One of my, I'm an Aries, so one of my, and it's so important that you understand, I believe, the astrological sign of your partner, because it digs into their deep psychology of why they do stuff. And if you don't understand why people do stuff, you're going to attribute your own perception of why they do it. You're going to assume, and then you're going to make up an intention for that person, and it could be completely wrong. So in your head, it's a conflict, but to them, it's something natural. So I really try to understand the other perspective for that reason, so I can understand things so that there's less conflict. And mm-hmm. one thing about Aries is that we tend to be very straightforward and less patient. So I have a problem with impatience. I don't wait long enough before I respond to something. That's one of my flaws. So if something makes me emotional, like when you feel kind of anxious or you feel that fire in the back of your neck, mm-hmm. you know, naturally I kind of, if I don't pause and literally maybe just walk away and kind of calm down or whatever it may be, then I'm going to make a stupid decision every single time. And that's my downfall every single time. But the fact that I know it and can be aware of it, I can work on it, you know, and yeah. I need somebody who understands that that's my downfall as well. And you need to understand their flaws and blah, blah, blah. But again, if I keep doing that with impatience, then they're going to reflect the impatience. They're not going to have patience with me when I do step across their boundaries, et cetera, et cetera.
Yep.
I wanted to tag on a Blood Dragon's point. How do you know if you're ready? But then somebody else says, Serpa says, exactly, are you ready yourself to allow another person in your life? And that's a good question, because for a long time I had my filter way up here. I was blocking out the opportunity for a long, long, long time because my standards were very high, because I have a mother who has values, you know, role model type of mother, certain characteristics, and I had a great grandmother as well. So when I think of a woman, I think of my grandmother's loyalty to my grandfather, how kind she was, how she can communicate, my mother's class, you know, a lot of different things. So my filter was like sky high, and I was blocking out a lot of girls for that reason. So regardless of the hundreds of thousands I would meet, I wouldn't even allow myself to even get to know them a little bit, because I would just automatically filter them out as a no. And, you know, you got to be careful, though, not to drop your guard too low, because once I came to that conclusion, I dropped my guard and I was too accepting, and I ended up, you know, being in a stupid scenario where that wasn't even my frequency. I don't even know how I got that low into a frequency, you know, and attracted that person.
No, I definitely can relate to that, because there was a date that I had before that, you know, was me resorting back to my older days, my younger days, I should say, of, you know, just kind of being, I guess, more the player or whatnot. And I quickly reeled it back in, because I had to realize, like, come on now, this is not what you're out here for. You know, you didn't decide that you wanted to become a single, to be out here, whatever. That's not what you wanted to do. You know, you're not looking for the one, but you're trying to improve yourself to attract the one. And so that's very, very important. That's a very important part, is that you cannot overlook that. You know, please realize that even when that person finally does come in your life, here's the thing about it that's going to be so beautiful about it. Once you decide to change who you are, not only does it attract them, but they almost become an extra ramp for you to continue to grow faster than you've ever grown before. Because when it's just about you and your motivation is this imaginary woman or man, whoever you're destined for, it's not enough, because you can't feel them. They're not physically there. But when you make the decision, like, I want to grow because I feel amazing becoming this person I'm becoming, then that person comes in your life. My lady came in my life. Then it became a checkpoint moment where she became a ramp that said, okay, I like you, but this is not going to last if you keep using them same habits that you're used to. I don't like arguing. I don't like this. I don't like that. And I was like, oh, I got to change that, and change that fast. And I'm ready to change that, because for you and for myself, first for myself, but for you, I'm willing to make this change. You fine. I'm hell yes. And because of that, it ramped everything up, and it actually improved me a lot faster than probably what I would have done on my own in 6 months. I did in 2 months.
Don't worry. exponential right there.
Oh, man. The right one will help that exponential growth, without a doubt in my mind.
The hearer had a question. She said, is she the only one in here that's a female? But I want to address her question. She said, what does one do? We're heading almost a three-hour stream straight, I mean, because we had a break in the stream before. But Tira says, what does one do when you cannot afford the help you know you can benefit from? I'd say that's what debt is. It's borrowing against the idea that you're going to give back with interest. I mean, it's the same concept with school. You borrow to go to school when you don't have the money. You borrow to get a car when you know. I don't know if you mean like, a course. I don't know what you're talking about, but borrow the money. If it's going to make you more money, that's an investment. Now you're turning that debt into, you're taking somebody else's money and multiplying it and getting free money for yourself, if that's the way you look at it.
Yeah.
So that was just a quick question I just saw. But we do have about 5 minutes left in the stream, about 3 hours straight.
But it's a good conversation, man. If you're ready to sign up, I'm surprised I was able to last this long.
Yeah, I'm really worried about you, man.
I'm still feeling the pain in the back of my head with this migraine. It's one of them things where you sleep the wrong way and you got nerve endings that go to the top of your head. So if people are seeing me rubbing my head or whatnot, that's because I still feel the pain, but I'm excited about this conversation. Mm-hmm. And seeing, you know, even with past space, because I've seen you comment on my videos as well. Like, it's so dope to see a person have a moment of clarity that says, you know what? Maybe I haven't been doing things, you know, you know, my absolute way is not the only way. Maybe I could try something different. And hopefully there was something that you learned, and everybody else too, that you learned from either one of, you know, Game and I talking, that, you know, the thing is, you're not going to be able to take all this information that Game and I have studied over years and years and retain that and have it and say it's going to change my life right now. You're going to be motivated probably for a day. Right. You'll come back to it. You'll get some reminders. Here's the thing that you really need to take from it. Take the tools and take certain one thing you could take from here. Just take one thing and say, you know what? I'm going to start implementing that today. That's what's going to make the real change. It's not going to be you. I'm motivated by you guys talking to me. And I see what y'all have put up on Twitter, like @BusyWorksBeast, @CurtisKing, man, y'all really motivated. And I'm like, I'm glad. But is it going to be sustainable? That's what I'm here for, is to make sure you have sustainable change. So take a tool. Take one tool from here. Go back and listen, even if it's just listening to segments. Take one tool and approach your business forward and say, here's the thing. If you don't like where your business is going, if you don't like what's happened, you're already ready for change. Change is going to happen either way. Even if your business fails, that's still change. Just open up yourself to one change. That's how it started with me. I went to a seminar for 3.5 days for Tony Robbins, and he threw so much information. I was like, how in the hell am I retaining even 10% of this? And then I walked away with just some very base level tools. I'll be good, because then I can go research the other ones and take those on when I'm ready. But it's like, same way you learn to make beats. You didn't go into making beats and say, I want to learn how to be, you know, Sunny Digital right now. Wait, what? You don't even know how to put your patterns down in the pattern selector situation. Like, you don't even know how to put the pattern blocks down. No, I want to be Metro Boomin today. Why are my 808s not banging? Like, no. Take your time. Respect every single step of the process. Stop worrying about the end result. Will keep you motivated, surely, but no. Mm-hmm. Focus on the baby steps, because if you have the patience and the diligence to take care of those, you'll blow the competition out the water.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point, because I was studying under Ron DeSilvestro at Forge Recording Studios the other day, and he knows so much about recording, period, that he's just shotgunning it out, you know, easy. But to me, mm-hmm. I'm like, it is overwhelming to a degree. I'm not saying he's not a good teacher. I just mean it's a lot of information to take in. So what I had to take away was a simple step-by-step process. Like, Ron, is this the first step when you walk into the studio? Is this the second step? That was the tool that I walked away with. Mm-hmm. I can always go back and research mics and compare the mics and the blends and all that. So we still have 100 people in here. That's a lot of people. I didn't want to eat up your personal time, though. I don't know what you're... Because you got a... You have a ceremony... Or you have a... you're getting hitched tomorrow.
That's tomorrow.
That's tomorrow. Yeah, yeah.
Did you have so a little more time? Because I just had to use the bathroom real quick.
Yeah, yeah. Same here. Okay. But go ahead.
Okay. We'll take. All right. You can run the ship here.
All right. Any questions while Game is going to handle his business right now? Any questions that you have so far? Some very valuable questions in here. I like seeing the varying of the questions because I think it does show that we all have very specific needs, although pretty much we all have the same needs of success and growth and what we want to do. Never feel like no matter how big your problem is, never feel like it's only your problem. So Penn Griffey said, who's a producer that inspires you today? Probably somebody you may or may not have heard of. It's a producer named THX. He's one of the most phenomenal producers, and he probably doesn't have like a bunch of behind the beat videos, but he's one of those producers that I see in live action. He can literally do anything. He can play any instrument in the band, and he can just make beats. Oh gosh, Leotis, my partner, he's another guy that just, I get inspired by seeing it in full action. Like anybody can make a behind the beat look amazing with a bunch of camera editing and a bunch of angles and the zooms in, zoom out, a little drone. Anybody can make a behind the beat sound amazing. But I love watching these dudes in action work from nothing and continued. Delon asks, do you meditate? I do meditate. Something that I've been reading as of late that may help you out is this book called Unplug by Suze Yalof. Basically, she describes ways that you can meditate in a day and age where we're all plugged in. So, yes, I do meditate. That is very important to get in my mind in the right place. Something that's important to understand is that in the first, I think it's the first 30 minutes or first 20 minutes of your day, your brain is moving at its fastest. It moves at 10.5 wave cycles when you wake up. What does that mean? That means that your brain is taking in information more at a higher rate than any other time of your day, which means that is going to ultimately determine the mood of your day. So if you're taking in a bunch of great information, like you're taking in meditation and you're breathing and all these things you're doing, you know, and being one with yourself at that point, you should have a great day. Won't be perfect, but the worst, you'll have a great day. But if the first thing you do when you get out of bed is roll over, take your phone off the charger and start reading your timeline, your social media timeline, your day's cooked because you're now allowing somebody else to dictate within that first 20 minutes what your 10.5 wave cycles are going to gobble up. If they gobble up somebody else that's hating on the Patriots because they lost last night, now your brain is going to be influenced by that energy. And whatever energy that is, whether it's bitterness, whether it's pettiness, you will be already be pretty much indoctrinated into that. And that will determine the mood of your day. You don't think it's right? Try it. I'll give you an example of how it works for somebody who works a 9-to-5. You wake up, you check your phone, and you get on Twitter. Somebody says, today is a really crappy day. You say, that's weird. It's only 6 a.m. How can it already be crappy? You get off the bed, you stub your toe. Whatever. That sucks. You go to your kitchen, you put your toast into the toaster, and you look on your phone, and then before you know it, you burnt your toast. But you're already late for work. You jump in the car. You get onto the on-ramp. Somebody cuts you off. That sucks. You keep going to another lane. Somebody else cuts you off. Then you miss your exit. Now you're 5 minutes late for work. Guess what? This day sucks. Just the same way your brain already prepared you to focus on all the negative things that happen instead of the great things and the abundant things because your brain already took that information in the first 20 minutes when it read that tweet. There are scientific facts that back that up. That's not just hearsay. That the first 20 minutes of your day determines the mood of your day. So be very careful about the things that you digest when you first wake up, because literally your days are being determined by them. Somebody come to you with some drama, like, no, chill out. I need my first 20 minutes. Give me a second. Then we get to it.
I agree. I mean, I kind of walked in on half of that. That's so true, man. Like, once that negative ball starts rolling, the whole day is going to be negative.
Mm-hmm.
It's so hard to like undo that negative ball. And I'm glad you gave out that. What was it? The 10.5
cycles? 10.5 wave cycles a second.
Yeah, so I'm glad you gave that out in the morning, because what's the habit I do? Even I, my phone goes off, first thing I check social media of some sort, whether it's YouTube, Instagram, or even Facebook sometimes, stupidly. First of all, let me tell you guys, when I went to Cali to visit my brother Curtis King and some other friends at in NAMM and all that, and to do the seminar, I didn't get on Facebook, and I had probably the most perfect 4 days of my life. I mean, I couldn't explain how much joy I had just staying away from negativity. You don't realize, like, you did that whole detox of social media, remember?
Yeah, that was everything. I needed that.
That was every social media?
That was every social. Well, unless you want to count YouTube as a social media.
Okay.
But the main ones that were like cutting the most into my my happiness: Facebook, Twitter, Instagram.
Yeah, you don't realize. I mean, guys, out of all the social media, Facebook has to be the most, like, we don't realize it's pulling us down, but it is. I only get on there because I have to post for some vertical relationships who own brands and different things. That's the only reason I get on, and to see if Sinead posted anything, because she posts some funny stuff, baby videos and stuff like that. Cute little stuff, which I appreciate. Everybody else is just, it's a drag. Like, you don't, like, I wish people in the chat could really know what it feels like to be around people like me and you in person. Like, that was, again, the greatest experience I've ever had in my whole career, in my whole, I can say, life. It was a perfect 4 days, in my opinion.
That's dope, man.
It was awesome. And, you know, once you, what am I trying to say? I'm trying to say, once you compare that realness of, like, love and appreciation to be around people, good people, you go back to Facebook and you're like, these, like, this is just hollowed out. I can't explain what I'm trying to say.
No, I understand what you're saying. You realize that life, real life, is not happening on Facebook. It's a representation of the things, you know. It's people sharing highlights with each other. Every day is not that remarkable for you. Not talking about you in particular, but people, you know, every day is not as bad as people want to make it is. Every day is not as excellent as they make it is. Everybody's relationship is not as great as it is. Like, that's why, like, even me and my lady, like, we clown each other so, like, we love each other so much, and we say some crazy stuff to each other in a loving way. I wouldn't even want to, like, put most of it out there, because I feel like now it makes it a parody of what it is. You know, like, this is ours. We need to have our moments. And I think that sometimes social media makes us believe, like, there is no real life that goes on. But I tell you, when I was shooting the music video with MERS over, I got invited to the Strange Music. Those who don't know Strange Music, like Tech N9ne and Chris Calico and Trav and everybody that's over there, I got invited to their headquarters. And I was so engulfed in all the information, all the things that I was experiencing. In the same way that you talk about game, like this experience, you were so distracted by all these wonderful things happening in real life, Facebook didn't even make sense to go to, right? And then when you go to it, it doesn't even feel real anymore. It's like, is this what you guys are focused on still?
Yeah,
I can do without that. I'm good. And that's sort of my relationship now with Facebook, is that, you know, had it not been for the fact that I know there's people there that need my information or my value, I wouldn't be there. You know, I'm trying to push them over to the ones that I can control more, so like Instagram and Twitter. And here's something else we can't ignore. You know, at its very core, social media is just a mirror. Social media gives us back the things that we react to either negatively or positively, because in their mind, they say if it keeps us there long enough, like, even something that, like, disgusts us. Like, I can even tell you, like, when there was videos every single week of another police shooting and an unarmed black man getting shot again, Facebook knew that if that came across my timeline, I couldn't ignore it. You know, even if I just looked at it and for a second was like, I can't believe this is on Facebook. This is sick. Right. They know now my algorithm will now be readjusted to where every video that comes up or every other video will now be that. Why? Because it keeps me on Facebook. It keeps the conversation. It keeps me, you know, in front of ads that they keep putting in front of my face. So literally, if you are depressed right now, stay the hell away from social media, because social media will basically, as, and it's not evil for that. They're not evil for that. That's just what their job is, to keep you on social media. They will literally put images back in your face of the very things that you are feeling. So if you're feeling depressed, you're going to see images of things that make you depressed. Like, for instance, I had a time period where I felt like everybody in my life was dying. Not even in my life. There's people in my Facebook. Come to find out, Facebook system basically detailed that every time I went down my timeline, the thing that got my attention was RIP so-and-so, so-and-so. So guess what Facebook does to keep me on Facebook the next time I sign in? Rest in peace, this person. Rest in peace, this person. Rest in peace, this person. Because that is their algorithm. That's they're basically giving back. They're giving me what I have asked for. And I didn't even know I was asking for it. Wow. So, you know, be careful about the places that you're in and where you go to sort of like get away from it, because that's their job. They're not evil. They're just literally it's almost like, you know, the 24-hour news cycle. You know, when Ted Turner created that, it wasn't necessarily him being the evil person. He just presented an idea. What people turn that into and spun it into, that's on them. What people consume, that is them. That's why I feel like news is the original algorithm. That's why the first 10 minutes of the news is the most negative thing in the world and makes you not even want to leave a house. That's the point. It draws a reaction out of you. And it's the same thing with this Facebook algorithm, Twitter algorithm, Instagram algorithm. They're not evil for it. Stop making them out to be bigger than what they are. They're literally giving you back what you have asked for. What are you asking for and why are you asking for it? That's a question you got to ask yourself and then change that eternally first.
I agree, man. I agree. And they openly claim that the news is an entertainment business. So Dallin, I'm assuming you answered Dallin's question, or Dalen. Probably saying that wrong. He said, do you meditate? I'm assuming that's what you answered with the book thing.
Yes. That's what got the conversation about the wave cycle started.
Okay, because I'm way back on the screen, which is different than the actual live chat, because I paused at that question because I wasn't sure if we were picking up, because a lot of people ask questions all in a row. Well, this is a little far-fetched, but Radio Illuminati says, what about the Illuminati in the music industry? Since you were talking about the algorithms of social media.
Here's the thing about it. Here's why I don't give too much thought to those things, because obviously, you know, people have things that drive them absolutely nuts and that they need to talk about at all times. Why you have conspiracy theorists that make these videos. Here's the thing about it. The powers that be, you don't have to worry about them. You have to be more concerned about your peers. Why? Because no longer are we living in a time where the media has to shun us, where the media has to change or even like censor what we do. We censor each other. You think about it, the outrage on the internet comes from people who are like supposedly some, you know, 45-year-old typing away a keyboard warrior making bad. Like, even, I'll give you an example, the Black Panther movie. Mm-hmm. Like, IDMB had to literally ban like these right wingers who were jumping on there and giving terrible reviews for a movie that didn't even come out yet. Right? And because it's all racially driven, we're censoring each other. They don't have to be powers that be that do anything. They've already taught. Like, if you want to go that deep into it, the lesson's already been taught. We're doing the work for them. Right. So people are so worried about like, oh, the powers that be are changing and da da da. No, the people are doing it for them because of their needs of vanity, their needs to be the center of attention, their needs to be offended, their needs to be better than the next person. That drives people to become more censored of the content that we share with one another, that even the information, even the fact that we can't cuss on YouTube and get our monetization. Mm-hmm. We did that to ourselves. It was other YouTubers who presented these problems. So we're censoring each other. We don't have to worry about the powers that be. They look at y'all like y'all are going to self-destruct yourselves, right? And I'm not saying that they don't exist, whatever they are. I don't know who they are. I ain't never been part of nothing like that. But I can tell you that most people do the work that they're so afraid of the powers that be doing. They do it for themselves. Mm-hmm. Out of their own needs and egos and vanity, they do it themselves.
Right.
It's crazy the day we're living in sometimes.
I used to believe in all that Illuminati stuff because it was a way to explain stuff that I didn't understand. So I always thought, again, it was that thing about when your spouse isn't contributing to your success, they feel like you did something evil to get your success. It's the same mentality about the Illuminati. We're like, how did, you know, I remember asking Superstar O on his live stream on Ustream back when Ustream was popping. I said, are you part of the Illuminati? Like, because I couldn't figure out what led to his success. You know, I had no idea. So I attributed it to some secret thing that only the evil people of the world could use and all this stuff. So, you know, again, it's for playground stuff. Of course, there's like laws. We're not going to get into the drug laws and all that holding black people back. I do understand there's a science to it. But again, as far as like these magical powers dictating your destiny, no, you create your own destiny. And I didn't know how much time you had left. Did you have to use the bathroom or something, you said?
No. If anything, I just need to lay down. I've been in here draining myself, man. But it's for a good reason. I just need to go ahead and lay down. My migraine has been knocking on my door. Like, yo, wrap it up, Curtis. You're talking too much. But no, I appreciate this conversation, man. And surely looking forward to the next time when I'm a married man at that time.
Yeah. There you go. I'm happy for you, man. So I guess we'll wrap it up. It has been a while, about 3 hours and a half. And we're just at 100 folks, so that's a good number to end it on.
Sure.
So again, this is Music Producer Conversations with Curtis King. There he is. And we appreciate you for joining in. Again, the questions that you may have, save them for next time. We're going to have more time to go in depth because right now you're asking really deep questions. Somebody asked, what's the truth behind 432 kilohertz vibration in human life? Yeah, that's going to take...
That's a whole conversation in itself. Oh, my gosh.
And it's 432 hertz, by the way, Gideon, not kilohertz. But all right, guys, thank you for watching. It's Busy Work. Well, it's Music Producer Conversations. There we go.